got to go big to go home. Go big to go home. Can we go bigger than yesterday is the question. So this is a call for everyone to go big. Go big. Yesterday I went so big that I couldn't even sleep last night. It was a bit of a problem. And my whole system was just reverberating. I watched this video that I compiled with these 140 some odd slides of Jesus in the Himalayan mountains. And the video was so astonishing that it just shook me to the core. And I actually, in YouTube, I pulled up some music and had that music then playing as I was watching this video. The video is actually silent, so anyone can use any music they want to as a background to it or view it silently. But it was the most extraordinary experience, so profound that my whole system was just reverberating all night. So I'm a little bit leery about even posting it on the internet. Actually, very potent medicine, to say the least. Speaking of medicine, I want to reiterate that we are told, let's put it this way, we hear about these gigantic cartels, these gigantic corporations, these shadow multinational corporations, brainwashing the world, controlling the world, which is very true, very true. But then we say, what are they? I mean, these oil companies must be the oil companies, the energy companies, the power companies, appliance companies, electric, internet companies. Well, yeah, it's banking, cartels. It's all of that. It's all of that. But we're leaving out the most powerful influence in the world right now. In modern culture, there's one influence behind this modern culture that is all powerful. Okay, and what is that? It is the pharmaceutical industry. Nothing comes close. They have shaped modern society. They're the ones who have the real money, the real power, the real influence to have fundamentally changed world culture. And in fact, there's a new world religion based on pharmaceuticals and what they want us to believe. And this is actually a religion. It is a religion. And what is so shocking is that this religion is being taught in schools. In fact, education is this religion. Government now is this religion. There's actually a state-sponsored religion. And children are being forced to attend these schools, unless they're homeschooled, it's catechism class is what they're really going to. The media, there's this massive global religion that is being forced upon people, and our tax dollars are subsidizing this, you see. And there's a whole bunch of ethical, legal issues here, because state and religion are supposed to be separate, and yet the state is now sponsoring this religion. So it's a drastic situation in the world. There was this pastor, I watched a video from this pastor once, and he was an expert on ancient languages and interpreting the Bible by knowing the true origin and derivatives of words. And he said that what Jesus said in the Bible was that in the end times, the world would be dominated by pharmaceutical interests. Okay, pharmaceutical interests. This is what he's the actual interpretation that he said in the Bible. This is what the real word meant. And lo and behold, this is exactly what the situation is. Now, I've said Jesus has returned May 1st, 2015, approximately there. He made an announcement that I'm back. I'm back now. And it's not any coincidence that this religion that is sponsored by pharmaceuticals is dominating. Let's keep in mind, what made Christianity so popular in the first place, okay? Let's just be straightforward here and obvious. What is it? Well, it's the miracles that Jesus did, right? And what were the miracles that Jesus did that are so well known and caused an uproar in the area? Healing, sicknesses, all sorts of sicknesses. Paralysis, leprosy, blindness, deafness. I mean, you name it, Jesus healed it like that, okay? This is what caused the uproar. So, and what did the apostles do after they were anointed at Pentecost? They went out throughout Asia Minor and in the Greco-Roman world area. They spread out. And what did they do? They healed. Insanity also. Mental disorders were healed by Jesus. all varieties of afflictions were healed by Jesus, just simply through spiritual clarity. Okay. And many healings by the apostles, miracles were just happening, so many. This is what spread Christianity, plain and simple. The literal experiencing of people of these dramatic healings, of illnesses that couldn't be healed at that time. Now, what has caused interest in religion to collapse? And it has collapsed. I mean, I spent a lifetime trying to get people interested in religion, and it's gone nowhere. And nobody's really interested. In fact, Jesus has already returned to this world and nobody's interested. Isn't that astonishing? Why? Because science and technology, pharmaceuticals and surgery have now taken over the business of healing. People don't need religion anymore for healing, they think. Okay. Even mental disease, you take all these antipsychotic drugs, you take, you know, everybody's drugged. And therefore, you know, their real interest in religion was the hope throughout the centuries, was the hope that if I went and prayed, if I went to see a holy person, I went to see relics of a saint, went to a church, you know, whatever, a holy place, and I would be healed. I would be healed of these terrible afflictions that the body gives rise, at least reflects, it comes from the mind, actually. Now, Jesus says everything comes from the mind. All illness is all disturbance is in the mind. The body is just a mirror. So this is what religion, people's interest in religion, has really been about. Now, Jesus said, actually, he came to bring eternal life. And that's what it's really about, is the promise of eternal life. But from a pragmatic standpoint, let's be honest, what's been driving religion is the hope that we can get healed from all these afflictions that we have, the cancers, you know, and what dealt a very severe blow to religion was the Black Plague, and they'd go to the priests and the bishops and the holy people, and they didn't, you know, nobody was spared, and they said, wow, somehow the power of God is not, you cannot handle this Black Plague, so they started turning more to science and saying, let's see if we can find some better way. So most people now, their interest in religion is about zero, actually. They might still keep the labels and just a pleasant, something to keep the family unit going and, you know, these kind of things. But in terms of healing, nobody really turns to church anymore. Christian Science was very popular in the 19th century and the earlier parts of the 20th century. Why? Because it was healing people. A lot of healings took place. It was mental, spiritual healing. New Thought was also healing. And people, you know, people get sick, they get old, and they go to, they're desperate for healing. And so they try to find something that will work. Well, Christian Science actually did work. And there was Christian Science healing centers in about every city, town in this country. And now, you know, it's just there have been so many laws passed by the pharmaceutical companies have lobbied to have all these laws passed where they're trying to eliminate their competition. Let's face it, religion is the competition of pharmaceutical companies. And vice versa. Okay, they're competitors here for our interest, our allegiance. And so, with these laws being passed against healing, I mean, Christian Scientists cannot allow their children to, you know, if they get ill, they use a mental cure, spiritual cure, and if it doesn't work, and then they're going to be held criminally liable, you know, for murder. This is what the pharmaceutical companies have done. Of course, they themselves have made sure that they're protected by the law, that they can, you know, people can die from drug overdoses, from their systems can be wiped out by drugs, and they have no liability whatsoever. You see, hardly any. So they've rigged the whole system. The whole world is rigged in favor of this new world religion right now. And for me, I was brought up Christian Scientist mostly, and not only that, but I totally believed in it. And my whole life, I've believed in it. I don't take drugs. I've never had any medical procedure. I had a tooth extracted. I actually refused to have that done for a long time and almost died. So I was really upset about that, that I wasn't able to, you know, to heal it. So I've not been able to, I've healed many afflictions have been healed. I have one right now. This morning it was so bad. My shoulder is so terrible. It's freezing up. It's locking up. I can't hardly move my arm, and it was so painful this morning. I was doing prayers, going vertical. Truth is true. Nothing else is true. Truth is true. Nothing else is true. I asked that the truth of this, the truth of God, be in this shoulder, you know. And if I have sinned against God, then let the full weight of judgment fall upon the shoulder instantly. Fall upon me instantly. I insisted upon it. And the pain vanished, okay, the pain vanished, but the affliction is still there, okay. I can hardly, you know, but it's a little better, but it's still there. It got a little better right away. So I'm just wondering, why is it that we're not able to heal? I have such conviction that I should just be able to heal anything, and yet it hasn't panned out that way. It's because I believe is the influence of pharmaceutical and science technology, pharmaceutical hospitals, you know, this is the biggest business in the world. Medical business is the biggest business in the world. It is the most powerful, it's the most all-pervasive. It's the one that has everybody's attention. And they have done such a job of brainwashing everyone that we're affected by that. And we don't have the conviction. Now, when I was doing this prayer this morning of going vertical, and the truth is true and nothing else is true. Truth 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 is true. I suddenly got this sort of like a shock through my system several times where the intensity built up to conviction. And that's when I felt that something was released. But you have to have this conviction. Now, we look at religion like the evangelical religion, Christianity. What is it? It's basically healing. Well, why is it so popular? People go there to get healed. These are healing revivals. You get these charismatic pastors who are up there, and they're bringing people up on the stage, and, you know, you're healed of this and healed of that. And actually, a lot of people do get healed. They're trying to keep alive, you know, faith healing. That's why it's popular. And it's getting more and more difficult. It's getting more and more difficult because we're told that we've been propagandized to say that this is superstitious and barbaric and ignorant, and we have, you know, modern science now, et cetera, but I'll tell you this, it's actually the pharmaceutical obsession and surgery and pharmaceuticals, that's actually what's barbaric. Spiritual healing is what's truly graceful and elegant and what we deserve. It's this savage, barbaric surgery and pharmaceutical drugging everybody. That's what's extremely barbaric. So we've really been lowered down into a very barbaric situation in the world. And we lack conviction. This is the trouble. Even I seem to lack conviction. It's very frustrating. I feel like I shouldn't. But the people in the past, they had this tremendous conviction. Because that was it. There was nothing else, you see. And it was the feeling like, this is it. This is all the marbles. I'm all in on this. And there'd been a tremendous, this was the medical system of the past to a large extent. There was some supplementation of that. But people did get well. You know, the touch of a saint, the glance of a saint, the prayers of a saint, they worked. St. Patrick, didn't St. Patrick go around doing a tremendous amount of healing? People of all sorts of afflictions would come and you know, rise, and you know, you're free of this affliction, and they'd be free of it. That's why I became so famous. Saints became famous because they healed people. And yet we have the pharmaceutical companies trying to completely wipe out any memory of any of this whatsoever. Someone says that chemtrails are actually spraying, they're trying to come up with some sort of chemical, some compound, a way of erasing historic memory. Okay, that's someone who said he worked as a biochemist on the program, said that's what their aim is to erase historic memory. Now, who do you think would be sponsoring such a thing? Pharmaceutical companies would. Because they don't want us to remember that we used to have this elegant way of healing, being free of afflictions. Just a simple, you know, simple prayer, a simple acceptance of God's judgment upon us, which is that we're perfect exactly as we were created, that truth is true. Simple affirmation that truth is true with the ringing clarity, and the affliction just vanishes like that. See, that is sophistication. That is true sophistication. this pumping everybody full of massive amounts of drugs and ruining their finances and forcing everyone into this forced healthcare systems and stuff. This is barbaric. This is extraordinarily barbaric. Now, you know, you can argue various ways in this, of course, but this is the big picture. The big picture, the facts are the pharmaceutical industry does dominate, is the most dominant force in the world right now. Nothing comes close. And the loss of interest in religion is directly tied into that. Absolutely. And the attempt, whether they're actually spraying historic, trying to get us to, they're trying to get us to not be aware of history in terms of yes, miracles did happen, healing did happen to an extraordinary extent. They don't want us to know that. They want us to be ignorant of that. So they don't want any competition. They don't want us turning back to that, you see. So they can continue to simply get the biggest revenue stream in history pouring into their pockets. I mean, they're inventing drugs now that there's not even a condition for. And they say, hey, you know, pretty soon they'll say, well, we have this drug, but it treats this, but nobody has this, so we want everybody to have this condition so that we can sell these drugs to you, you know. Oh, yeah, well, you know, so the commercials are like, do you have this? Do you have this? These symptoms, and they try to tell these very symptoms, which everybody has. And they say, oh, you might have this condition. And they make up some name for a condition. And they say, we got this drug for you now, wonderful drug. Go to your doctor and see. And so the doctors, you know, say, oh yeah, you should try this because, you know, there's all sorts of kickbacks to doctors and programs. I mean, it's so corrupt. As our doctor says, an honest doctor, he says, we're just, you know, they're just drug pushers. They're just drug pushers. Doctors are just drug pushers, plain and simple. They've been corrupted through and through and through. I don't go to doctors. Try not to, you know. Yeah, the doctors will tell you straight out. I mean, there are a lot of good doctors. I mean, really. But they hate the system. They hate what's going on. They really do. Because good doctors will know, you know, a lot of being a doctor is actually being a therapist, psychotherapist, is a lot of people go in for complaints all the time. Oh, I got this feeling here and here. I feel terrible, doctor. Doctors will do all these tests on you, you know, and look at you and talk to you and ask questions and say, okay, now what you want to do is want to alter your diet a little bit, get a little more exercise, and, you know, and then they listen to you saying, oh, it hurts so much. And then you leave and say, oh, I feel so much better. I feel so much better. Yeah. And they're good for a while. You know, it's like going to a therapist, really. A lot of it is. And this is what, you know, religion used to be, the priests, the pastors, the rabbis, etc. You would go to them and they would listen to you and say, oh yes, there's a prayer for that. Yes, absolutely. That's a spiritual affliction. You've lost some faith in God, and here's, you say this prayer like this, you do this and this, and you'll be well. And actually Jesus says all illness is psychosomatic. It all is in the mind, 100%. 100%. He says all these pharmaceuticals are actually just placebos. This is what Jesus says. They're actually placebos. So that's why you have the pharmaceutical industry has to constantly, they sponsor so much of the content that we get in the world, both on the internet, on television, in movies, in news, in school. Their money is poured into this content. Why? And it's often behind the scenes, you know, subtly. Because they have to keep us believing that we need this. Because actually, everything that they're selling are actually placebos. 100% placebos. Even surgery is a placebo, Jesus says. Everything you do to the body is just placebo. It's actually, the body is just an image in the mind. And it's just a disguise. Actually, the body is just like this mask to really try to hide what we're really up to. Okay, what we're really up to. It's a way to pretend that spirit is dead, but spirit really isn't dead. It's trying to deceive God. It's trying to deceive itself. It's trying to deceive guilt, and the bodies are really just like a hat we're wearing or a mask we're wearing. And the illnesses, the things that happen with the body, that's actually happening in the mind. It's actually happening in the mind. And Jesus is very adamant about this. So, Jesus has come back, and I told Jesus, first of all, Jesus, Jesus said, "Will you do this for me?" And I said, "I'll do it for you." And Jesus said, "I don't know. I don't know. Proof's in the pudding." And I said, "No, I'll do it." And he said, "Well, you know, we'll see. We'll see." I felt like saying, "I don't know if you'll do this." Well, I have, at least so far. And then in return, I said to Jesus, I said, "I'll do this, Jesus, but I guarantee you, you come back, nobody's going to pay any attention to you." I said, "Nobody's going to pay attention to you." And he's back, and so far, you know, no one's been paying attention at all. And so I said, "I think I know this world, what's going on." But obviously, he knows better than I do. So he, you know, he there must there's a bigger picture. But I mean, it is somewhat of a truism. I mean, that at this point, that nobody's paying attention at all. Because they're afraid that maybe the pharmaceutical industries will get angry with them and start putting some stuff in their pills that will really wipe them out. They say, "Oh, I don't want to seem to be psychotic, and I'm believing in Jesus." And maybe, you know, they're going to start, the doctor starts prescribing this, you know, antipsychotics, or government, the government religion, which is when you go to school, you are attending catechism class, plain and simple. The teachers are religious instructors in school, no question about it. And they're being taught now to be very, they're very much trained to identify thought patterns in the students that identify resistance to the pharmaceutical culture that we live in. And to flag, the teachers are really there to flag symptoms like, uh-oh, here's a student that needs some go to a guidance counselor, and then the guidance counselor needs to turn to a psychotherapist, and the psychotherapist then needs to get them on medication like that. That's what they're there for. They work for the pharmaceutical industry, actually. It's an insanely corrupt system right now, that's taking place right under our noses. This is happening. I certainly was aware of it. I was brought up, trained to be aware, being a fundamentally a Christian scientist. My grandma was a Christian scientist, and this came through in our family. My dad very much believed in that, and I absolutely believed in it. I didn't need to be taught. I knew it was true, and so I've always been very aware of the pharmaceutical industry and big medicine and what's been going on, and how it's infiltrated the educational system now through and through and through. And how now parents are trained to identify anything in their children that could require pharmaceuticals, and immediately, you know, get them on drugs. Because again, they're guarding against any trend which will start to point out that they're all really placebos. This whole thing is just placebos. It's all in the mind. Everything is in the mind that we think we're experiencing the body. The body's just in the mind. Now, it's frustrating knowing this and yet still, you know, still being sick, etc. Understandable, I mean, but that has not swayed me one bit. I understand that means that I must be lukewarm. It's not God's fault. I'm just lukewarm. And I'm trying to fix that, trying to go vertical. So we live in this most drastic of times, actually, because the last thing you want to do is to get hooked on this ideology that the pharmaceutical interests are indoctrinating everyone from cradle to grave. That's the last thing anybody wants to get hooked on, because it's not true. It's not true, and you're going to have to undo all of that. You're going to have to unlearn all of that. And it's not easy because you'd be lukewarm, you know, and it's frustrating, right? Now, I used to have a, you know, I've had all sorts of troubles, and the one was a severe anxiety problem. Couldn't sleep at all. It was most drastic because it went on years and years and years and years, and it was so terrible. I decided, well, okay, I just can't beat this with my mind right now. I just and I don't think I can make it. So I took a mild like Valium for a little while, like a couple months or something. It wasn't that long. I took just minimal amount, like one a day or something. I was still suffering terribly, but it just eased it a little bit. And then I was studying A Course in Miracles, and then I decided, you know what, I believe I'm going to be able to get it with this A Course in Miracles. So, and then I just stopped. I stopped. I eased off. I backed off gradually, and then stopped, and went with A Course in Miracles, and you know, gradually the anxiety was gradually reduced, gradually reduced, gradually reduced, And it's been like a miracle, but it's taken a long time. It's been, just a massive amount of work because we're so indoctrinated, that it's the body is somehow controlling the mind, and it's very difficult. Now I feel like I should be able to heal any affliction shouldn't even arise in the first place. I mean, I'm always astonished that anything affliction arises at all. It shouldn't. But that has to do with, it's not God's fault, it's my own lukewarmness. It's going horizontal. As soon as you go horizontal and believe there's two wills, you're subject to all affliction, every kind of affliction, aging affliction. As you get older, you start getting, the joints start wearing down. You start getting all sorts of pain in your joints. The muscles get stiff and tired and they don't work so well. And you get severe pain, and my wrist locked up on me. I couldn't even write. Couldn't even use my hand to write because the pain was so severe. I said, what is this? This shouldn't be happening. Why? Because I don't need it to happen. I accept God's judgment upon me. So what I did was I said, I accept God's judgment upon this shoulder, this instant. God's final, full and final judgment upon me. And all, what any consequences of that judgment, I expect all the effects of God's judgment upon this shoulder, this very instant. And since final God's judgment has to be true, there can't possibly be any need for time in between to adjust it. It must be true right now. So I insisted on God's final judgment and the effects of that upon the shoulder right this instant. And I did get some relief, actually. The acute pain, vanished. Now, the problem, whatever it is, I don't know what it is. It's quite odd, but it's a mental complex somehow that is affecting the shoulder. Now this is how to pray. I'm working on prayer to help people certainly get free of their afflictions. I understand afflictions. I've suffered from them my entire life, terribly, which is why I'm so focused on this. And the doctor said there's nothing we can do for you really. There was a period where I did take like antidepressants. I've been through that, and they didn't work. They made things worse, actually, worse. The doctor said, "We don't have any medication. We don't have anything that we can do for you. You're on your own. Sorry." And even the psychotherapist said, "There's nothing we can do for you." And so I said, "Wow, okay. So Course in Miracles are nothing." And so this is super motivated. So I'm super motivated to get to the truth. That what is the truth? Truth is true. How do you go vertical? Truth is true. That's how you go to vertical. So we live in an extraordinarily barbaric world right now, culture. Extraordinarily barbaric. I call it sophisticated savagery. I mean, those who understand, healing of the mind, how the mind can go vertical and just heal all affliction like that. We get tugged into the horizontal, and then and the afflictions arise and we need to go back vertical. Afflictions just should just vanish, melt away. They look at this culture as like just absolute savagery, Witch doctors passing out placebos, I mean, it's just like... And it's true. This is a very, very fallen culture and world right now. Of course, the pharmaceutical industry is lobbying for us to believe we're going into some super sophisticated, wonderful world, which is what? Based on pharmaceuticals. From cradle to grave, you'll be popping pills, having procedures. Now it's just common as can be. Hip replacement, knee replacement, just whatever is getting cranky, just have it replaced. So don't worry. You're living in this fabulous world where, of course, I talked to somebody who did have a hip procedure. They said it was hell. It was hell. But it does keep people going. There's no question about it. There is some utilitarian functions happening. But it's very barbaric compared to what we could be doing, which is we could be having perfect health. For as long as we want it, actually. Jesus says, actually, the body can be in absolute, perfect functioning condition for as long as we want it, period. He said, that's what it should be. Not even aging. flawless. He said it should be absolute flawless. He said your body, you can have the body in absolutely flawless condition where it doesn't draw any attention to itself whatsoever in terms of not, the functioning is just flawless and perfect, as, you know, fresh as a daisy. No accidents, no sicknesses, nothing. For as long as you want it. As long as you want it. You can have as long as you want. And he says, now, most just would decide, well, I don't really want to keep it that long. I have much better things to do than you know, be formless. And but we can if we want to. And he said, this is what would be termed normal. This is what's sane, sanity. Absolutely. He says, you can do this here. So, we're not taught that, are we? We're taught, well, all this stuff is inevitable, inevitable, inevitable. You know, dementia is inevitable. They get Alzheimer's, that's it, you know. And then he says, no, it's not. There's no such thing as an inevitable illness or inevitable situation. We're completely sovereign over our entire experiencing. There's no such thing as inevitability, except that we'll eventually drop the silly dream, right, of pretending to be dead. You know, so the power of spirit is no longer there, right? We're no longer sovereign, that the flesh is ruling over us. What better scenario of that spirit is dead than the flesh rules over it, right? And the spirit is helpless to do anything like that. And body has to keep popping pills because spirit can't do anything to help it out, you know. Absolute madness. Back to this video that I made. I don't know what to do with it. It's so potent that I don't know whether to maybe put little snippets of it, little bit by bit by bit by bit. This, I'm still jazzed up. I'm still just I couldn't sleep. Maybe it has something to do with the music I put with it too, which was really punchy music. It was very emotional, very emotionalized music, and the whole thing was very, very intense experience. Good God. I say produced by the Holy Spirit because it was a miracle. I mean, how this happened, I you know, if you went back and, did I prefigure this? No. None of it. I just said, why don't the Holy Spirit, I just felt, why don't I try this? Why don't I try this? Why don't I try this? And I did this. And an idea popped in my head, do this. And then it's like, oh, then finally said, how about putting this together in a video? Well, you know, okay. I have the, and then what kind of, how would I do this? And then, boom. Wow. High art. High cultural art. High spiritual art. You know, the highest I've ever seen. Use backgrounds by Nicholas Roerich, and the image of Jesus there was painted by Gustave Doré. Doré, this famous painter, you know. And so a little help from our friends. It shows you how, it's quite extraordinary. It shows you how when you are inspired in some way, in this world, when you're inspired in some way in this world, even though back in history, you see, they're not here anymore, but look what happens later on. Somebody puts it all together in a certain way and is inspired by the Holy Spirit, and we get something that's very sublime, very, very sublime. And it's thanks to, you know, those artists, Gustave Doré and Nicholas Roerich, who are also inspired by the Holy Spirit, you see. And then I just was the, you know, the quote-unquote technician, the artist technician that put it together under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit and came up with something very, very sublime, very sacred, very sublime. It depicts Jesus coming back into the world. It expresses it, the imagery. Is when in the dream that I saw Jesus come back in the world, I saw him coming down from this high mountain range, like the Himalayan mountains. You know, it's just a hot, really massive high mountain range, and he had come down from on high from this massive mountain range, down onto the plains, into the plains, and that's where I was, just right in this transition area from the mountains to the plains there. That's where then Jesus said, announce to the world, I'm back. My full attention is now with you. My full attention is here now. Okay, so we're going to get it done, whatever it is. Oh, a message, okay. Oh, one of these things, you've used too much data. Yeah, to heck with this. To heck with technology. I mean, it's so barbaric, really. It is truly barbaric. When we start finding out what we really can do, then this present culture, we will look back on this as just like a cartoon, some sort of barbaric Flintstone cartoon, really. And but we're not going to get there by following the lead of the pharmaceutical companies at all. We're going to get there by following the lead of Jesus, actually. Jesus is absolutely aware of the totality of our, you know, of our beingness and how it is that we're, you know, stuck, supposedly, and how it is that we can get unstuck. We will get free of this barbaric situation, this barbaric cartoon, by following the lead of Jesus. So the video commemorates, is a commemorative video that commemorates the return of Jesus, commemorating the return of Jesus. This is what it's about. I think I said something like gratitude for ingratitude. I can't remember, but there's something about gratitude, appreciation and gratitude for the return of Jesus. Appreciation and gratitude for the return of Jesus. It commemorates Jesus' return, which has already happened. So I wanted to commemorate this, and the Holy Spirit helped me put together this video. And you can use any music you want to behind it. Like I said, just open up another tab in your browser, find a YouTube song you want, or if you have a CD or MP3 player or whatever, or, you know, music on your computer, you can listen to the music behind it, or you can listen to it just silent, you know, and do prayers. I mean, you can use it all. You can use it to just say truth is true and nothing else is true. Truth is true and nothing else is true. Have a set of affirmations that you use. Let God's full judgment rest upon me this very instant. It's very important that this very instant, keep reinforcing this. And I am committed to the belief in it, that this of ultimately we will free ourselves from the ambiguity and reluctance, and we will have conviction with this, and we will truly, all affliction will vanish from us, even to the extent that we'll be able to, well, who knows, we will find out. But it will open the door, we will open the door upon, you know, tremendous glory, and affliction will be no more. We will look back on that as a silly joke. What a joke. Playing with the idea that there was some separate will, some other will other than God's, is what got us into this trouble in the first place. That's the entire thing. That's why I say it's all one. There's only one will. It's God's will. There is no other will. And asserting this, and asserting with conviction. See, it's not. Don't supplicate. Don't pray in supplication. This is the problem. This is why we came up short. Is religion got into supplication instead of assertion? You must assert it, not supplicate it. You can't say, well, God, I'm there's this other will, you know, can you help this other will out, because this other will is making me sick, so can you please help me out with this other will? And, you know, not that ultimately doesn't work at all, and leads us in right into the jaws of pharmaceutical interests. So what you have to do is don't supplicate, don't plead on your knees. No, assert. Say truth is true and nothing else is true. Truth is true right now. Truth is true right now. I insist that the full final judgment of God rest upon me this very instant, now and forever. The truth must, justice, God's justice, let God's justice be upon me this instant. You know, demand it. You know, assert it, demand it like that. Had the courage to do that. This is where we're lacking. We're lacking in that courage and conviction. There's no question about it. This is the frustration I have. I came in this world very intense, full of conviction, but the the currents in this world of science and technology were so strong that they pushed back so strongly that it cowed me into just, anxiety, because I was too afraid to be this way. I couldn't be myself in the world. This is the problem we have right now, is that nobody's allowed to be authentic, okay? Nobody's allowed to be authentic in the world anymore. This is why people are, warming up to Donald Trump. The political candidate is, they feel he's authentic, because they asked him, the debates, what about that? You haven't debated August 6th. And he says, well, I don't know. I don't think I'm going to do very well there, because I've never debated. I'm not a debater, so I have no practice, so I don't think I'm going to do very well. And they said, well, aren't you going to practice? And he says, no. Why? He says, I know who I am. I know who I am. That's it. That's authentic. He's full of bluster and bravado and exaggeration and showmanship and all this kind of stuff. And I don't like how he glamorizes women, Miss Teen, Miss USA, Miss World, Miss Universe, all that. I hate that. There's parts of his character, that are not endearing at all. Some people I might say he's an egomaniac or something, but there is part which is, he's not a politician, he's a businessman, and he's authentic. He's authentic in some ways, and people are feeling that authenticity. It's like, wow, where'd this go? I haven't seen this in decades. I mean, maybe my whole life, I've never come across anyone who's actually authentic in the media, the public eye. And even out in the world, you don't meet people who are authentic. You meet people who are eccentric, but not authentic. Our authenticity has gone into eccentricity, actually. The more authentic you are, the more truly religious you are, actually, because that is our authentic being. The more you assert truth, the more you're able to assert truth. And so I wanted to assert truth in this world, and my teachers immediately called me out, the whole corporate, military-industrial complex, as Eisenhower called it, but it's really the military-industrial pharmaceutical complex. There's another big corporation, which is often chastised as the military-industrial complex, the weapons manufacturers. But that's nothing compared to the pharmaceutical industry in terms of power. That idea of fomenting war, absolutely, the arms manufacturers have always done that, of course. Big profits for them. But they pale in power to the pharmaceutical industry. And the pharmaceutical industry also benefits from war to some extent, right? The more people taking, they send their agents all over the world promoting medicine. You got to take this guy to get hooked on it. And people are absolutely hooked on everywhere I go. I'm aware of the whole, a home care industry, assisted living industry, all this stuff. I mean, you go there and the people just have a mountain of pills. They have carousels full of pills. They have so many pills, they can't keep track of them. They need somebody there just to make sure they don't mess up on taking the wrong pills every day. I mean, it's just a constant feeding. They take more pills than they do food. It's a fact. So, lack of authenticity in the world. And so you get a little bit of authenticity in the political spectrum. So the Donald is just saying, hey, I'm smart. He says, well, what do you not worry? No, I'm not worried. I'm smart. I don't have notes. Do I have notes? No, I have a great memory. Okay. And I don't need a teleprompter. I just speak, spontaneously. I'm smart. That's why. I got a grasp of the issues, and let's just talk about it straight out. He's not this weaselly lawyer politician who, which we hate, is so inauthentic. So inauthentic. And we want authenticity. Everybody wants to be authentic. And the culture does not allow us to be authentic at all. It's turning us into little plastic robots, actually. And it's becoming repulsive. I actually turned on the television yesterday, and I wanted to see what was up with the Trump, And so I went to these various channels, which I never do. It's been years since I've even turned any of these channels on. You name it, MSNBC, Fox, whatever, right? CNN. Years. I do not watch. All I watch is baseball and golf and a little bit of basketball. That's it. But I decided, well, okay, let's take a look and see. Holy cow. I was just switching between channels, and CNN had something on the Jonestown massacre. They're showing all these bodies lying dead. Every channel's talking about death, sickness. Crime. And then they have a humor show, and it's like so unfunny. I just like, and the people on the show are just like, I say, who are, what is, what in the world is this? This is so inauthentic. It's just mind-blowingly inauthentic, the whole thing. And it's repulsive. I can't take this. This is just hideous. You feel like you're losing your authenticity by putting any attention on this at all. And this is really why people are attracted to Trump. He just says, hey, to heck with the world, you know. Nobody can tell me what to say, you know. And this is what we would all like to be like, that in terms of nobody can tell me what to say. Well, the fact is he can afford an army of lawyers to protect him, and we can't. We can't. There's a big difference. But we would all like to feel like we can say whatever we want to say. But look at the what happened to him. I mean, they tried to cut him to pieces. You know, Macy's, you know, by the way, cut up your Macy's card if you can. I don't shop at Macy's, haven't in a long time. I can't stand Macy's. You know, they just chopped him off immediately. And ESPN also chopped him off. PGA Tour actually chopped him off. Look at these sycophants. I mean, these people say, how dare you be authentic? You know, and authenticity sometimes, it's not all lawyerly. You know, basically they're telling us we all have to be lawyers. You know, diplomat, politician, slimy, weaselly lawyers. This is what we're being told, we have to be this way. Our little actresses and actors, you know, who are promoting a pharmaceutical, you know, agenda in the world in many, many ways. So keep in mind that when you tear down religion, you're promoting the pharmaceutical industry and regime, the pharmaceutical religion. Absolutely, that's what it's about. Now, when I talk about religion, I'm only talking about making it better. I'm not saying get rid of it. I'm saying make it authentic. You know, it's become inauthentic. It's becoming more and more fake and more and more fake. It needs to become more and more authentic, which is more and more conviction, which is, you know, it needs to become apostolic again. It has to be, we need an apostolic culture again. But I told Jesus, nobody's going to listen to you. I mean, the people here are like zombies right now. And just looking at the television, I mean, the difference between like 3 years ago or how long it's been since I even looked at anything, it's just like, jaw-dropping, you know. But people, they look to me like they're made of plastic. And they have some millennials on the show, and they're talking about the older people, like the older people are like some weird aliens. Like, what are these weird aliens doing on our planet, you know? They're still using flip phones. My gosh, that must be some kind of medical condition. I think we have a treatment for that, don't we? Well, we should, you know, like that. You know, I mean, these people are so inauthentic. They're just absolute puppets for the pharmaceutical industry. This is what you're getting. And this is part of an overall, you know, pretending to be deadness, which is what spirit is engaged in, pretending to be dead. So it can keep alive the notion that it can be greater than God. This whole charade of spirit playing dead is keeping alive, at least in our mind, in the mind of spirit, it believes this is the only way it can keep alive the notion of being greater than God. Like, this is the only way we can experience that, is that we have a plan to experience it. Okay, so we're not really experiencing being greater than God. What we're experiencing is a plan that we hope, that we believe will ultimately allow us to experience being greater than God. And that's where we feel then we'll be authentic then. So we say this inauthenticity that we're being pressured into is necessary to reach authenticity later on in time, space, process, and form. That once we convince guilt that we really have died, somehow guilt will disappear, and then we will be able to authentically experience being greater than God. That's when we'll experience it. Right now, we're not experiencing it, but we're engaged in this process, you know, a process that will ultimately result in that. This is what we're going through. So, of course, we're sick, we die, but we say, well, that's just a process. We got to go through the process, you know. Pharmaceutical industry's helping us, you know. It's so terrible, so many afflictions, but I'll keep popping the pills and eventually we'll get there, you know, that kind of thing. This is everybody's attitude. They resign. Well, I just got to wait. Eventually we'll get there. No, we'll never get there. When you realize you will never get there, then you realize this is all charade. This is all complete sham. You don't need it. And then you need to turn to become authentic again. and say, hey, I'm not dead. Guess what, God? I'm not dead. I've never died. I never did anything to you. If I ever did anything to you, if I ever sinned against you, bring then the full weight of your justice this very instant upon me. And we have to stand up and say this, because the ego uses this as a bargaining chip to corrupt us into believing we have to fall off this plan, you know, playing dead. That the ego says, hey, I'll go lean. God says, God's going to annihilate you, but I'll go easy on you. Don't worry, I have a plan to help you out here. I'm your friend, you know. So if you don't turn to God and say authentically, okay, God, you know, if I have truly sinned against you, then I deserve punishment. I deserve your justice, not the ego's justice, not any leniency. I deserve your justice, the justice of truth upon me right this moment. I don't deserve some, you know, some time to think it over or to get ready for it or some grace period where I still get to indulge in it. No, I mean, if I truly have sinned, I truly deserve the punishment this very instant, because that is truth, okay? Truth is not subject to time. Okay, so if I have sinned, whatever sins I have done, if any, I want the full justice, your justice upon me this very instant. This calls the ego's bluff. Okay, this is how you call the ego's bluff, and you have to do it like this. Okay, and I am doing it like this, and I, you know, and this is what we're all afraid of. We never go that far, do we? We say, oh my gosh, I. Now, the Christians, the way that they were able to do it was to say that all of God's justice and anger at us was directed onto Jesus and killed Jesus' spirit, and that therefore God was no longer angry with us. So that those God's all the wrath of God's justice for our sins against God was poured out on Jesus. So then we could go to God and say, hey, God, can you please, I know that you're no longer angry at me, so let your justice be upon me, which I know will be okay now. But of course, there's a problem with that. Is that is saying that someone did sin against God? Is it basically saying we did sin against God, except the justice got displaced from us onto Jesus? That doesn't solve our problems. And obviously, if you look at the world now, is Christianity and religion in general in the world is more and more succumbing to the pharmaceutical regime. Okay. Whereas if it was what we were doing was true, we wouldn't have done that. So that doesn't work. That's not honest. It's very dishonest. It's called, you know, a sacrificial atonement, in that we made that up. It doesn't work, because that means that we did sin against God, which is a lie, which is our arrogance. So we need to get straight, and Jesus is straightening us out. Say no, just go straight to God. Say, God, if I ever sinned against you, let the full weight of the punishment, of the justice, or whatever justice mets out to me from truth, whatever truth, justice, truth mets out to me, let this justice be done to me this very instant. Hold nothing back. Whatever the effects are, let it happen right now. And of course, what we're really allowing is perfection to dawn upon us, because we never did anything to God. We never sinned against God. We never sinned against God at all. We didn't change the will of God at all. Not one tiny bit. Nothing whatsoever. So justice, perfect justice from God, is absolute grace and perfection and the dawning of bliss upon us. That is the fact. That is a fact. See, we're punishing ourselves. We're playing dead. You know, thinking that we have to do this because we've sinned against God. And so we feel trapped. Even when we say, hey, wait a minute, I don't want to try and be greater than God, we still have this problem and think, well, what do I do with having sinned against God now? So what they came up with is, well, let's get a sacrificial atonement. Let's get Jesus to take all the sins, the punishment for all our sins onto him. He paid the price, in other words. And then that'll free us. But that too was run into a roadblock here. It hasn't worked, because we keep getting all those afflictions. I say, well, what the heck can I do about that, you know? And so we become vulnerable. And then we think that, well, how can we function again? That if we have the power to sin against God, how can we ever, you know, function and be truly function the way we're supposed to function? Is there going to be some tension and some fear there, and, you know, uneasy? So they could never quite get right with God. You see, they kept trying to get right with God through the idea of vicarious atonement, sacrificial atonement, and they never did get right with God. It was dishonest. You know, they were trying to have it both ways, is what the problem was. So the last 2,000 years of Christianity is a situation of trying to have it both ways. Now, this has been changed over the last, 150 years. It began to go towards having it just one way, which is truth, that we never did sin against God. This is the real message. We were so into pretending to be dead that we felt that we must have sinned against God, and we didn't want to, we sort of, okay, let me give up trying to be greater than God, and yet I still have all this belief that I did sin against God, all this evidence. So how do I reconcile with God? And so they've been struggling with this issue for thousands of years, but now, some are getting very clear about this, that no, we never sinned against God, and so therefore calling upon God's justice to directly come upon me, this is the way. We don't need a vicarious sacrificial atonement. So that's why, Jesus said, I come back in friendship. He's not coming back as a sacrificial lamb. He's coming back in friendship. Because I don't need any vicarious sacrificial atonement or anything. I mean, that's dishonest and totally dishonest, ridiculous, right? If I sin against God, I deserve the punishment. All right, that's a violation of truth. I mean, we're making up the rules of reality by saying there's a vicarious atonement. That's complete arrogance. There's no such thing in reality whatsoever. And so, be able to call upon God's justice upon you directly. This is getting back to authenticity. It's getting back to authenticity. See, what people really want is spiritual authenticity. Spiritual authenticity, and this is what Jesus is bringing back to the world, I hope. This is what I'm trying to give to the world here. Has not caught on yet, has not caught on yet. Maybe that's the grace of the Holy Spirit, right? Remember John the Baptist, very spiritually authentic. Okay, the whole countryside came to see him. Because they were looking for remission of sins, because they felt the sins are causing all the sickness. So they said, "Well, just be baptized, and be cleansed of your sins." Just they needed some placebo, some way to think, that you need to somehow do something, needed to do something of faith, And then, so now we're much, much clearer. I know I am for sure about the entire situation. So we can't. Be angry at ourselves, blame ourselves. We did the best we could based on very severe fear. Okay, so at least we were trying. I believe at least our intentions were good. We said we want to reconcile with God. All right. So I don't blame religion, in the various things that, baptism, water, the sacraments, the vicarious atonement, sacrifice, died for us. We were trying to reconcile with God, and that's right. But what we need to realize now is we never left. We never sinned at all. And so all we have to, it's very simple. All we have to do is just accept this fact that there isn't any choice between wills. There's no choice to make at all. We're perfect. It's not like we choose between perfection and imperfection. There is no such choice. Happiness and unhappiness, there is no such choice. The belief that there is such a choice is the insanity. It's not that it's actually there, but to believe that it is there is the insanity. So we've just been in a state of whimsical insanity, willful arrogance, actually, to claim that there is such a choice, but that there isn't. So we never sinned against God. We had this idea of could we be the creator of the creator, but this is just a silly adventure, God created us to be, just immaculately adventurous, So we said, wow, how adventurous can we be? Let's see. Let's try this out. This is the ultimate. Let's see if we can even change God. Well, we can't. We can't, in our freedom, we can't bind ourselves, actually. We cannot change the fact that we're free. But we tried to do so, but there's no harm. It didn't harm God. It didn't harm us. It didn't do anything. So there's no sin. There's nothing to atone for, actually. There's absolutely nothing to atone for. This is the real message of atonement, is there's nothing to atone for. So who knows? Maybe there'll be a like a Trump-like situation, spiritual Trumpism, you know? It's a funny thing that now, like all these businesses and schools now are being giving guidelines to how to identify the Donald Trump in your midst, the Trumpism, and how to suppress it. How to suppress it? Like, are they say, are there Trumps? Is there any Donald Trump-like people in your business? There might be. And here's what you do if they try to pull this nonsense on you. Here's how you deal with them. You know, so they're already become, you know, being extremely suppressive to any authenticity. Basically, what they're saying is, is there anyone authentic in your school or in your business? Well, if they start expressing their authenticity, here's how you crush them. Here's how you crush them. It's exactly what they're doing. So all I do in these videos is express my authenticity to the extent that I have it right now. And I can't do this out in society at all. Out in society, I'm just a little wallflower, you know. What did I say? I said I was invisible. Yeah. I was at the grocery store a couple days ago, and I had another invisibility counter where some lady got something, and then the cashier just turned to her. I was in line with the basket, everything. And she was getting a couple of Pepsis, and she said, "Oh, you want those? Okay." And the cashier started ringing her up. And then the cashier turned to me and saw me, and her mouth just dropped and said, "Oh my God, I'm so sorry. I didn't even see you there. I didn't even notice. And she's like freaked out. She said, "How could I not know you're there? Their basket was there. You were there. I completely didn't even see you at all. It was unbelievable." And she was just shocked. And she kept apologizing and apologizing. I said, "Don't worry. I'm just working on my invisibility. You know, it's okay." I'm doing pretty good. I'm doing pretty good. She goes, "Yeah." But she was really alarmed that she had just not see me at all. Yeah, freaked her out. She's a good person, but so I said, "Oh, it gives me more time to hang out with you. You know, it's all good. It's nice and cool in here." And we laughed, but still, she was alarmed. How could I do that? It's weird. So, you know, so out in the world, you can't be authentic. As far as I'm not able to be authentic yet in the world. I mean, people just say, "Oh my gosh, how do I crush that authenticity?" I mean, the pharmaceutical industry has brainwashed, indoctrinated the entire planet to crush authenticity. Crush because they know where that leads. Ultimately, it leads to putting them out of business, okay? Or they have to downsize, you know, they would have to downsize and ultimately diversify. Like anything that's no longer needed in culture, you know, first it's downsized and then it's diversified and ultimately, you know, that it's finished. That's happened over and over and over again to many, many businesses here. It's just how it happens here. And yet, you know, they want to try and make sure it doesn't happen to them. So the actual roles that we play, we're being taught extremely rigid roles by the pharmaceutical influence through all the propaganda outlets. Indoctrination means all the means and ways and means of indoctrination are being heavily guided and influenced by the pharmaceutical industry and allied industries. And what they do is they teach us very rigid roles to be inauthentic. They teach us to be inauthentic, and they tell us that being inauthentic is advancement. We're advancing into this great millennium where we're all going to be very, very happy because we've crushed authenticity. Once we crush authenticity, then there's nothing to get in our way. What they really mean is they're going to be very happy. The pharmaceutical industry is going to be very, very happy because they're going to feel like they just have unlimited cash cows from cradle to grave, just pouring all working just to pay. You know, all their money goes straight to them. So they think, yeah, we're going to be really happy once we crush, you know, once we crush authenticity. So the very rigid roles that we're being taught, and people now are locked into those roles very severely, is to crush authenticity. I mean, I feel it. I feel like every day I go out, I feel I want to be authentic. And even if I be a little bit authentic, people look at me like, "Huh? That looks like something I need to crush, you know. Looks like a bug. Like, is that a cockroach I need to crush, you know? Oh, you know, oops. It's, oh, no. I don't know what happened to me. Oh. I was just about ready to crush you. I thought you were a cockroach, but, you know, okay." And so there's this terrible fear. If you're a very authentic person, then there's this terrible fear in the world now of I don't dare be authentic. And this is what caused me the problem, depression, anxiety when I was younger. I was very authentic. I was very outspoken. I was very intuitive. I was very spiritual. And people just said, "Wow, you can't do that. The pharmaceutical industry doesn't like that. The doctors don't like that. We don't, you know, that's not the future. You can't be that. We can't. Our future is to be inauthentic, and we'll be good little plastic robots, and someone's going to be really happy, and that happiness will trickle down to us. So sure, yeah, the corporate fat cats, oh yeah, their happiness is really going to trickle down. Everyone's going to be happy, right? As long as you keep taking drugs constantly and start being sick to take them. Of course, what they'll do is preventative drugs. That's already big industry too. Vitamins, no different. It's all placebo. Vitamins are placebos. Drugs are placebos. All medicine is placebos. I don't really differentiate at all between any of them. It's all the same. I know the health vitamin nuts will be so upset about that. There's a massive industry now in preventative medicine. This is where it's going to. You see, they're covering both angles. They say, how can we get the most amount of money? Okay, well, if you get sick, we'll give you all those drugs, but also we're going to promote massive preventative medicine. Just take this stuff constantly, all these pills and vitamins, this. That's just a gigantic. So the combination of the pharmaceutical and food industry and everything is all one cabal, basically saying, how can we keep you from being authentic? Because authenticity automatically goes towards recognizing your beingness, recognizing your true power, recognizing your genuine authenticity. It's like, hey, I can be perfectly well for as long as I want. I don't need anything whatsoever. Ultimately, we don't even need to eat. That's a fact. That's really a fact. Just because the body is really has no needs at all. Ultimate authenticity, which Jesus represents, our ultimate authenticity. Jesus is a perfect example of our ultimate authenticity. And he tells us that the body has no needs at all. No needs at all. Doesn't even need to breathe, doesn't need to eat, doesn't need to sleep, doesn't need to take medicines, doesn't need to protect itself, doesn't need anything. All needs are projected upon the body by the mind, Jesus says. So we can easily just project, this complete authenticity, and the body is just absolutely fresh and healthy and calm and peaceful and doesn't get in our way at all. Doesn't get in our way at all. So trying to push this authenticity through in the world, I'm having a terrible, difficult time because, trying to do it in public. I mean, you're persona non grata. Even if a little bit of authenticity slips out. Now, you can be eccentric. You go to San Francisco or Berkeley or Santa Cruz or whatever and be eccentric. That's okay as long as you're on drugs. I mean, if you're on drugs, you can do pretty much anything you want to do. And today, I mean, if you can even, commit all sorts of crimes and they'll say, oh, well, they were on drugs. That's why it's okay. Yeah. It's the drugs. Well, if they're on drugs, well, that's not so bad. The poor person. I found some drugs this morning. I took some med. I took these pills. I took the wrong pills, or I, whatever. And you shot somebody and say, "Oh, you mean you were on some medication? Oh, really? Oh my gosh. Well, maybe we just need to get you on the right medication. Poor guy. Here, let's give you some more medication." And it's really like that. This is where we're going, right? Or, well, it just didn't have the right drugs. That's why they did whatever they did. It's just a matter of finding the right drugs and everything will be fine. As long as we get everybody on the right drugs, the whole society will be perfectly happy. And so, yeah, if you want to be like that, you want to be on drugs and then you start, shouting in public or something and people look, are they on drugs? Are they under influence? And oh yeah, okay, everything's fine. It's not really authentic. It's just fake authenticity. It's drug authenticity, It's fake drug authenticity. And they say, oh, okay, no problem. In fact, they celebrate it. They say, all right, man, that's cool. Yeah. You acted out like an idiot. That's great, As long as you're not truly authentic. Now, if you go to these places like San Francisco, Berkeley, etc., and you're truly authentic, they would put you, lock you away in Alcatraz. They'd reopen Alcatraz and put you in the deepest, darkest cell possible. That's the one thing that they absolutely hate. They're so terrified of it. Terrified of it. That's why they're promoting all this fake authenticity. Is because they're terrified of true authenticity. Absolutely terrified of it. The long arm of the pharmaceutical industry is soaking everything. Soaking everything. That's where the money is. That's where the money is. You think about it, the amount of money that people poor, and of course we're subsidizing it all. I mean, basically, you work to subsidize the pharmaceutical industry in this world through massive, fees and taxes and medical insurance and all that kind of stuff. It's just subsidizing the pharmaceutical industry, so that people can have. I mean, people have like $1,500 a month bills. This is not uncommon at all in pharmaceuticals. Get froze up on me. Why'd you freeze up on me? Keep going. Okay, it's still going. Yeah. So $1,500 a month, that's what, $18,000 a year, right? $18,000 a year, $20,000 a year. People are pouring in, you know, the pharmaceutical companies, and this is coming from, you know, hundreds of millions and billions of people, just so many people. And so the younger people are basically working to just subsidize that industry. Everybody is. I am. My God, that's all I do is work just to pay, you know, medical, subsidize your medical insurance. That's all my money goes, just straight right into that. Nothing left over, actually. Totally insane. Yeah. And I felt I had to adopt a compromise position because it was impossible to be authentic here. I couldn't, absolutely could not find a way to do that. Now, the 60s, we were trying to be authentic, you know, but it was the only way people could do it was drugs. And what it really was, the 60s, was telling us that the way to authenticity was through drugs. And of course, the Beatles were a big part of that. You know, they were very large drug users, and were, their music was heavily laden with drug innuendo, and it was perfectly permissible, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then there's a massive industry, music industry, was just basically working for the pharmaceutical companies. They were pushing drugs on youth. I mean, the drug lyrics, I mean, the whole drug culture of music, which I was very much aware of, everybody was using drugs, and the music was heavily supportive and encouraging drug use. And saying that this is authenticity. When you're on drugs, you're being authentic. You know? Now, the thing is, when people are on drugs, they feel that less social inhibitions, so they may feel like they're acting more authentic. But then they become addicted to the drugs in order to feel authentic. You see, that's the problem. So true authenticity was replaced with this fake authenticity under the influence of drugs and music. So people go to a music concert and, you know, screaming. They say, I'm being authentic, I'm being crazy. That's not real authenticity, really. That's not really a real authenticity. I'm a bhakti, you know, free love. You know, everyone's on drugs. And that's not real bhakti. That's not real authenticity. That's not yani, the bhakti, whatever, you know. No, it's not authenticity at all. Authenticity is saying, I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. See, truth is true. Truth is true. Truth is true right now. Truth is always true. There's only one will, and that's the will of God. Let God's justice fall upon me this very instant. You know, be authentic with God. Real authenticity has to do with God, you see, and being authentic with that. Not going to some concert and acting like a berserker. So, certainly starting with the British invasion. Now, the certainly music before that also was heavily pushing drugs of tranquilizers and alcohol, actually. Cigarettes, alcohol. Alcohol was one of the major drugs that was pushed in the United States, around the world. And the music, if you listen to it in the 40s and 50s and stuff, it's like, oh, you just want to drink. I mean, it's very much geared towards you altering your mood through alcohol or sleeping pills. I mean, the industry back then was, you know, sleeping pills, alcohol, various painkillers and stuff like that, and Quaaludes, whatever. And so the Beatles came along, and they were pushing, you know, more drugs, different kinds of drugs, uppers. They were very much into uppers. In Hamburg, you know, they were using uppers like crazy. I mean, they just lived on drugs, actually, just popping them all the time, playing like maniacs. You know, pot, psychedelics, uppers, but a lot of speed, all sorts of speed, and, you know, cocaine and all this kind of stuff. They were pushing all. The musicians are drug pushers, let's be honest. They're drug pushers, by and large. This is how they've been used. And the big music companies were heavily, a lot of them financed and owned in part by, you know, there's interlocking directorships with the pharmaceutical industries. Is like this octopus, has enormous influence. And they promote certain types of music. Somebody there, I don't know. they know what they're doing. The producers, the whole industry knows they want to get this certain tone, set a certain tone for society. And the tone they want to set is, hey, drugs make you feel authentic. And that's the direction they want us to go in. If you look back in hindsight, it's a no-brainer. I was aware of this as it was happening, but it's just overwhelming. But looking back now, you see the validation. It's absolutely what happened. Is they wanted to move society in the direction of saying the only way to authenticity is through drugs. That's it. And once you get people hooked on taking drugs, either taking drugs, then as they get older, they just keep on taking popping pills, more expensive, high blood pressure, diabetes, all these whatever, arthritis. You go on and on and on and on, just popping pills, popping pills, popping pills, and then watching the media that reinforces that that's what you're supposed to do. You're a good person. You're an enlightened person. You're a sophisticated person. Which is, of course, how they sold cigarettes, which is a drug too. Well, the original drug company was the tobacco company. Of course, now, they're the villains because we say we got more sophisticated drugs, more now, and so we want you doing that. But originally, the tobacco companies, big tobacco, was really, and alcohol, were the two big drug companies, and they marketed to tobacco and alcohol as meaning you're sophisticated. This is how you're sophisticated. In other words, this is how you're authentic. You're not a barbarian. You're an authentic sophisticate, because you're smoking. And so they all this placement in movies and is very, very important. Everything you're watching has intense placement. Every show you're watching on television, every show, every movie you're going to, all the content you're seeing, by and large, is heavily subsidized by placement by these industries. And placement is very subtle. I mean, they're very sophisticated how they do it. And what they're doing is subliminally and not so subliminally, making you feel that our product makes you authentic, makes you funny, makes you sophisticated, makes you attractive, makes you authentic, right? They're selling authenticity. It's drugs, these products. So they use cigarettes, and they place them on all the starlets and stars, and this and people say, "Well, I smoke." You look at these people, and there's so many people of that generation grew up in the 40s, 50s. I talk with them, and they say, "I smoked, I smoked." These people, they all smoked. I said, "Why do you smoke?" He says, "Because I, that's what that's how you were seen as the smart crowd, the sophisticated crowd. If you didn't smoke, you were seen as some kind of redneck hick from the backwoods who hadn't got the memo yet of how to be sophisticated." Well, that's just going on now to an extraordinary extent. If you do not do what these massive, interlocking, powerful companies want you to do, then you're branded as regressive, and you're suppressing progressive culture. They think that if you don't go along with the so-called progressive culture, you're suppressing happiness. Now, there's still some conservative churches in the world, but they're under enormous pressure and attack. Evangelicals, the black church, conservative black church, very conservative. There's some people, members of the black church in America, for instance, who, they never drink. They don't smoke. They don't drink. The Mormon church is very conservative about various things like that. So there's still some underlying tones of Christianity. But by and large, it's all being collapsed. It's all being collapsed, unfortunately. And the pressure is just in school, which is, again, religious catechism. We understand that this pharmaceutical culture is a religion. It's a religion of happiness. Religion really has to do with our happiness. Where do we find our happiness? Okay. They're absolutely all about our happiness, saying this is where you find your happiness. It's in the future. Okay, it's in the future. Once we accomplish, something is accomplished, then we'll be happy. And in order to get there, you've got to crush your true authenticity. In other words, you have to truly be dead to your true authenticity, which is spirit. And once you're truly dead to your true authenticity, then that will convince guilt that you've died. And then guilt will say, okay, I don't need any more payment. I've been satisfied. I've been neutralized. It will neutralize guilt. And guilt in a neutralized condition is like zero. And therefore, then we'll be authentically happy and will be greater than God at that point. So this is what they're promoting. This is a religion. It's called the Antichrist religion. Antichrist religion is promoting happiness in a direction where you'll never find it. Okay, but it is still a religion. Religion is about, where do we find our happiness? Where do we find our true satisfaction? Where do we try to find our true authenticity? And so Christ tells us that we find our true authenticity by recognizing we never sinned against God, and therefore we can ask God for justice upon us right now, and that justice will be the grace of God, the blessings of God, the bliss of our authenticity will be flawless, and we'll experience it. And then this is how we're reconciled to what we are, by realizing we never did anything against God at all. This is the teachings of Christ. The teachings of the Antichrist say we have to completely destroy our authenticity before we can be authentic. Because once we destroy our authenticity, we'll neutralize guilt, and then we will be truly happy, and even more happy than before, because we'll be greater than God. You know, this is the Antichrist teaching religion. So the pharmaceutical industry is absolutely the high priesthood of Antichrist religion. And this Antichrist religion is what is being taught cradle to grave in this world from every possible angle. And the resistance to it is just, you know, crumbling away. And even those people who want to be authentic, you know, you meet some of these religious people, you feel there's some authenticity to them, you know, but it's still very circumscribed. You got to watch out what they say. You can't say. The only person right now in the world that is acting authentic is Donald Trump, because he has billions of dollars. Well, he's inflated what he has, and they're trying to cut off his revenue stream as fast as possible. Yeah, will cut off his legs, you know. Which I'm sure they probably will accomplish it. I mean, you're going to run out of money at some point. But he's the only one who can afford it to say. He can say whatever he wants to say, basically. And in the power structure of the world, who people are all completely bought and paid for by the pharmaceutical industry and the allied industries, they're like attack dogs. They're ferociously upset with him. That you can't say that. Nobody can say that in my country. I have the power to suppress and control culture. I'm the high priest of this Antichrist religion. How dare you speak up and say and pretend to be authentic? How dare you be authentic like that? How dare you not show obeisance and cringe before me? Cringe before the high priesthood. Priestess is really one way to put it too, right? How dare you not cringe before the priestesshood, and how dare you be authentic like that, not afraid of us? You know, if you're not afraid of them, they absolutely hate you. Like the media, they hate you. If you're not afraid of them, they want you to be afraid of them. That's the priestesshood and the allied, their helpers, the priesthood. It's really the priestesshood that's in charge. And the priesthood is now kind of like their sidekicks for a little while until they figure out how to really run the whole show themselves. Because they want to get the moms, you see. They have to get the moms. They want the indoctrination of the children. It's the mother that controls the medicine to the child. Okay, this is very important. So they from the very get-go, they went after the women. And they had to get the women indoctrinated first. And they promised them, we'll give you full control over society if you just agree to, you know, drug your children. From get them the get-go. And they said, okay, you know, it sounds like I want my children to be happy. And they said, well, this is how they're going to be happy. Are you sure? He says, of course. You know, you don't want them to be sick, and you want them to develop properly, you want them to do good in school. And gradually they worked on women's minds, and, you know, it succeeded, you know, to a large extent. There's still some women who are vociferous opponents of this, but they don't quite see the full context of the situation. They just know something's very wrong, because they're being pressured to indoctrinate their children into an Antichrist religion. There's no question about it. This is what's happening. I mean, the Antichrist is, you know, this hideous vampire has got its fangs into this world. And Jesus knows this very well. That's why he's back. He's back. I mean, people got to start realizing he is back. He's here. His full attention is on this situation right now. Here, he knew very well that this would happen, and it has happened, and he has some remedy for us, okay? And we need to prepare to feel comfortable around Jesus, okay? And so we can listen, hear the remedy, don't distort it, understand it, you know, move towards acceptance of it, and all of that. Because we hate being inauthentic. This is the feeling I have. I feel like I can't be authentic in this world. It is absolutely horrible. You know, the rabbis have a tradition in the Middle Ages and various places of these very authentic rabbis, and you know, the wonder workers, miracle workers. You know, various places, Russia and various places, there's famous rabbis who are extraordinarily authentic. And they did miracles, absolutely did all sorts of miracles. Absolutely they did. And the people love them. And so this is passed down, you know, and so remember the rabbi back, you know, what, 500 years ago, 600 years ago, there was one, a very authentic rabbi, and there's another one over here 300 years ago or something. But, you know, I mean, now, where do you get this authenticity? There have been traditions in all religions of this, of people very authentic. Well, we want to be like that. We want to be this passionate authenticity. It's not erotic passion at all. See, the pharmaceutical companies want to channel all your passion into eroticism. So they have all this, the priestesshood, you know, smirking and giggling and talking about eroticism and the books they read and the erotic books they read, and saying this is how you're authentic. You know, you want to be authentic. Well, this is how, you know, I'm the high priestess of authenticity. You know, which is channeling your passion of authenticity into eroticism, which is, you know, antichrist teaching, 100% antichrist teaching. Though the love of God is completely non-erotic, actually. Completely non-erotic. Absolutely. It's a spiritual love. Agape, as the Christian tradition teaches, it's agape. It's not romantic love. It's not erotic love. It's not any of that. So these rabbis, these saints, and, you know, these holy people, these gurus, they're so authentic. But the authentic, and then so passionate. The presence was, you know, passionate. Yes, I'm, you know, God is with me. I am with God. You know, God's justice is upon me, has been upon me fully. And God's judgment upon me is nothing but all, just grace. And the grace, you know, flows out as authenticity that, yes, you are also sinless. You are also sinless, actually. This is the passion, that you are sinless. You are sinless. We're all sinless. This is the passion. But the Antichrist is trying to get, you know, they're trying to indoctrinate children now into eroticism at an earlier and earlier and earlier age, and convincing the mothers that this is okay. And of course the mothers are furious about it. The mothers have been fighting this battle against the Antichrist, and, you know, they've been losing. And part of the problem is, it's difficult to determine exactly, but they've been losing, unfortunately, because the pressure has been put on them as mothers. You know, they can pull their child out of school. I mean, they're involved with their child's schooling. So when they say, well, this is what we're teaching your, you know, your children, they say, hey, wait a minute, you know. So they have to convince the mothers that this is okay. So the overwhelming attempt of the pharmaceutical and the Antichrist religion has been directed towards women, the marketing, and they're telling women this is how you become sophisticated. And of course women are very much interested in being sophisticated and being smart. They don't want to be seen as just some dreary dumb housewife, so to speak, right? They have a hunger to be authentic. And so the pharmaceutical industry is saying, this is how you be authentic. And they're controlling the narrative of authenticity for women. This was their goal. And then once they do that, then the women will do what they say to the children. The mothers will raise children the way that they tell them they want the children to be raised. This is the whole thing. And the men, they're told, just don't pay attention to them. They don't know what they're talking about. Because what happens if the husband comes home and he's somewhat authentic and says, hey, what do you mean? I don't want all these inoculations. I don't want this. And backs the woman up. You know, they don't want to say, no, don't pay attention, man. He's an idiot. We're not even talking to him anyway. And this in the commercials is all is always the way. The man's the idiot. The man's the buffoon. The man's the guy that has to turn to the woman for the ultimate answer. And the woman is the one who's been indoctrinated by the pharmaceutical industry to say, oh yeah, this is how we're happy. And the man goes, oh, how come I didn't know that? I must be really stupid. And he goes, yeah, you know, yeah, of course we know that. It's not a surprise. It's still an idiot. Once an idiot, always an idiot. So what they want to teach women is don't listen to men at all, because they're afraid. Through historically, more men become authentic because of the focus on religion, authenticity. They don't want women listening to men at all, because they can't quite indoctrinate men quite as easily. You know, they put their full effort onto women, so there might be some men slip through the cracks. They're very nervous about that. So they're teaching women, don't pay any attention to anything a man says. Doesn't matter. They're idiots. They haven't got their religion yet. They haven't had the catechism. It says, you've had full catechism, right? They haven't. They can't accept the communion wafer of pills, you know. They haven't been through proper formation. So they're not on the inside. They're on the outside of this religion. But the religion is between us and you. We're special. We have this special relationship. You know, the man doesn't really share in that. So the women's most important relationship now is with this entertainment and movies, entertainment, television, magazines, all this stuff, and the pharmaceutical industry. And they're feeling this a special relationship, and that they're involved in this new religion of where how to find true happiness. And then the pharmaceutical industry says, don't worry, the man's upset, he's angry. Eventually, when you find true happiness, he'll understand, and it'll trickle down to him too, you know, through eroticism or something, they tell you. Oh yeah, that's how to make the man happy, right? As if that's how men are made happy, is the woman is great in bed, so that's all a man needs, right? That's authenticity for the man, right? This is what they're teaching. You know, they're antichrist, plain and simple. So, and what do you have? You have the man, Trump. He's out there, like, being authentic to the extent that he can be. And people are just like, what? You know, this is what? I mean, authenticity. I mean, really? What is this? It's authenticity. Oh, my gosh, I thought it was extinct. Really, it's like there's some, like, you know, carrier pigeon or something. Like, Donald Trump is like some carrier pigeon that, like, we thought it was extinct. We hear about the animals that we thought were extinct, and then like 50 years later, one shows up somewhere, and we're like, oh my God, I thought it's like the Trump is like, we thought he was extinct. What happened? Where's he been? You know, what's going on here? I thought authenticity was extinct, but it's not. Wow, it's interesting. So they're frantic, they're freaking out. But it's possible that this is just a distraction also. If you look at Trump's, you know, his obsession with huge buildings and glamorizing women to the ultimate extent, you know, it's very possible that this is all an intentional distraction away from Jesus, actually, which is true authenticity, where what Trump is doing is giving us a little authenticity so that we're distracted away from where the great authenticity is coming from. On the other hand, getting a taste of that authenticity might whet the appetite for more. So it's a slippery slope, isn't it? But people are, you know, people are so desperate for authenticity, it's like somebody, you know, diving underwater, and you're trying to come up for breath, and you look up, and the surface is, oh, this is so far away. How can I make it? And your lungs are just burning, and you're just desperate for air. That's how desperate people are for authenticity right now. That's why the Antichrist is trying to generate as much fake authenticity as possible. But obviously, Trump is panicking them. Although they're trying to figure out, how do we deal with this? How do we co-opt this? How do we co-opt it? The media people can just see their thought process and everything they write about and say, okay, we got to suppress this. How do we suppress this? You know, they're all suppressives. Antichrists, their whole purpose is to suppress authenticity. That is their purpose. They want to make us make spirit completely dead, make us completely kill authenticity. Authenticity is our true nature. Spirit is absolutely free, and that's true authenticity. They wanted to absolutely kill that, suppress it, destroy it, crush it, so it's no longer, wipe it out. And they think that then that will convince guilt that spirit's dead, therefore, and then guilt will be neutralized, and it will vanish, and then we'll be, then we can be authentic. See, so it's always time-based, it's always doing-based, it's always based on suppressing authenticity. This is the Antichrist approach. This is the ego, called, Jesus called it the egoic approach, egoic, you know, Antichrist approach. It's the approach that doesn't work. It's the path of futility, it's the path of darkness. But it always claims that going into that darkness is, you know, this is where you're going to find your happiness. So I saw in a dream what's going to happen in this world, and it's happening exactly the way it was shown to me. And I was shown that during the presidency of this 44th presidency, this time we're in right now, is we're going to come, the road is going to go into this dark tunnel, completely pitch dark tunnel. I mean, it's so dark. And people will, like Pied Pipers, they're going to go into that tunnel and disappear into that tunnel, because that is designed to crush their authenticity, to completely destroy it. And they think then that's when they'll find their happiness. So they go into that dark tunnel thinking, this is how I find my happiness. Okay, in the pharmaceutical industry, say, don't worry, we got medicines for all the strange, bizarre acting outness that's going to happen as your authenticity keeps bubbling to the surface. Desperately saying, I need air, I need to breathe. And oh, we have a drug for that. Don't worry, we'll give you some fake air. you won't need air. You know, we'll just medicate you so heavily. So this is what's happening. This is what's happening. The Antichrist is leading us into this dark tunnel, into this mountain, like a tunnel that just dead ends. You know, it doesn't go anywhere, it just keeps going into this down in this mountain. Doesn't, and there's nothing there except just darkness and hell. And we think, though, that's the way to find our happiness, because we have to crush our authenticity in order to convince guilt that we're dead, in order to pay the price for killing God, which we think we did, which we imagine we did. And what Jesus comes to tell us is, you didn't kill God. It was all in your imagination. You didn't do anything to God. You didn't change the will of God one bit. So there's absolutely no guilt at all. You don't have to try and pay the price, convince guilt that you died. You don't have to die for what you never did. And all you have to do is reconcile with God, is admit that you didn't, you know, is accept the fact you didn't sin against God. And so then ask God to reconcile with God. You say, ask God, okay, God, go ahead and apply your justice to me. I accept your justice, knowing that the justice is your reconciliation to the realization of your perfection. First through an intermediate step of pretending to be eternal life, and then after that, finally experiencing the eternal life, perfection of eternal life. This is the true teachings of Jesus Christ. So you could compare that with the Antichrist teachings of this world, and it's very obvious what's going on. And just the situation with Trump, it just shows you how desperately we've fallen, how deeply we've fallen. I mean, back in the 60s, someone like Trump wouldn't even be paid attention to. There were so many people more authentic than that. There's authenticity all over the place. But unfortunately, it was, some was genuine authenticity, some was starting to get into drug authenticity. And so you can see what happened with the fake authenticity of drugs, how it's led us to this abominable situation we're at now. You know, I can see Trump at the debates just, you know, not doing well, but you say, hey, it doesn't matter. You know, debates don't solve anything. You know, what does debates have to do with being successful in business? You got to make deals. You got to be smart. You know, debating is just for the pajama boys and girls, you know, who want to seem like, yeah, I went to Harvard or something. It says, what the heck does that have to do with anything? You know, that's not how you deal with the Chinese and get into some, you know, debate. Like, I got a 90-minute response, and you respond. I mean, it's silly. It's silly. You're trying to show how smart you are. How smart you are has to do with making good, tough deals, you know? Come on. It's ridiculous, you know? And people will say, yeah, it is stupid, isn't it? It is really stupid. What is this? It's not an intellectual beauty contest, is it? Debate beauty contest? But to say that women can discover their authenticity through beauty, you know, and glamour is very wrong. On the other hand, you know, it's possible that it's promoting traditional values too. I mean, there's a possibility of that, where it's saying don't become a drug pusher, don't fall for the scam of the Antichrist, you know, trying to lure you into that and be a promoter of that. Just stick with the traditional value of, you know, of that, you know, that way. You know, that's, you can look at it two different ways. But, no, the, you know, it's anyway, glass half empty, glass half full. You can make lemonade out of lemons, you know. It's possible. But the reaction is what's more important, is the reaction of people saying, my God, we're dying here. I mean, the culture of lawyers and pharmaceutical industry, this Antichrist culture, is crushing our authenticity. And it's like we're almost dead. You know, we feel like it's almost gone. And it is. It is. I go out and all I see is plasticity. I don't see any authenticity anywhere. I mean, it's like, it's vanished. It's extinct. And that's very frightening. See, that gets to you. It gets into you. And you feel like you need to suppress yourself. Most of the suppression is self-suppression, self-censorship. Because say everybody else is doing it, and if I don't do it to myself, they're going to do it to me. It's going to be a lot worse. You know, they're going to, you know, lock me in jail, throw away the key. I better suppress myself. This is what people are doing. Every day somebody's apologizing for something they said. It's unbelievable. What was the latest thing? Oh yeah, ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous. I mean, you cannot, because what the pharmaceutical industry is telling everybody, that everybody has access to drugs, so we're all equal. What are you talking about? You're less than me. No, you can go down to the drugstore and get something for your headache just the same as somebody else can. So we're all equal. This guy, what he did, I'm not going to say his name. He pointed out something about this country, this cult, you know, is not as intellectually sophisticated as this country, which is true. They don't have the traditions, you know. Okay, yeah. You might go to the Zambezi or I don't know, someplace, and you go to different countries, and you know, it's not like they're full of Ivy League colleges, right? And it's very sophisticated intellectual, Oxbridge people. And so, okay, you say, well, okay, you don't have that infrastructure there. And as he pointed out, they don't have the infrastructure there, so it's not like, you know, they're deep thinkers and all that kind of stuff. Boom, fired. Fired. Racism, you know. This is all the influence of the Antichrist culture. Is how dare you say that they don't have these sophisticated colleges? What does that have the heck to do with anything? They've got our medicines there, don't they? Can't they go down to the pharmacies and buy the medicines we have? Well, then they're just as good as you, aren't they? Yeah, the leveling down of the world into a third world planet is so that everybody thinks that happiness is just having access to pharmaceuticals, and they don't need higher education, really, or you don't need real authentic education at all. There's no difference in anybody. That's what they're telling you. This whole idea of one world, one this, is the pharmaceutical industry is telling us, hey, wait a minute, we can distribute our drugs everywhere, so everybody has equal access to happiness. So they think that they're selling happiness to the world. Antichrist is selling happiness. And so how dare you suggest that these people can't be just as happy as you can? How dare you suggest that having a Harvard, you know, PhD from Harvard is any better than somebody who like, you know, puts tires on a car for a living in a ghetto, you know? Now they have access to our medicines just the same as you. They can go down and get, you know, high blood pressure medicine just the same as you. Our medicine we sell them is just as good as your medicine. So their happiness is just as good as your happiness. You know, it doesn't matter. Somebody, you know, knows Christ, and it is, well, they have, you know, somebody's, you know, some Satan worshiper. You know, well, they both can have access to the same medicine. So what's the difference? You know, this is the ideology. The political correctness, you might say, is really PC, is really pharmaceutical culture. That's what PC really stands for. Is it political correctness? But it's really pharmaceutical correctness or pharmaceutical culture that is being pressed upon us. So you have somebody who's full of projections and believing in Antichrist. Happiness is destroying my authenticity. In other words, they're completely delusional, and they're going to be suffering from all sorts of mental problems and sicknesses down the road from all this. And yet, you freed yourself from this to a large extent by a right religious education, you know. And the notion that somehow you're equal on this particular playing field, you know, which is pragmatically we have to look at, is utterly absurd. It's utterly absurd. But the pharmaceutical culture is insisting that if you don't insist that you're equal on this playing field. I mean, obviously, in the eyes of God, we're all perfect. Okay, but in far as getting free of delusion, we're temporarily not equal at all. There's all sorts of temporary inequality there, and that has to be recognized. I mean, you don't put the inmates in charge of the asylum. I mean, if you got an insane asylum, what do? You got therapists there who supposedly are understanding, have a strong character, and the right tools, mental tools. They don't allow transference. They don't allow projection. You know, they're aware of this, all this stuff. They're trained. They're able to help. Now, if you just say, "Wait a minute," there's no difference between the therapist and the people here that have mental problems. There's no difference. That they're equal. They're equal. So, what do you mean you got to go to therapy? That's ridiculous. You know, the society collapses into insanity. And the pharmaceutical side, it doesn't matter. You know, you have access to antipsychotics. Everybody does. So, you know, that's happiness. So they're trying to collapse any differentiation down, any intelligent, pragmatic differentiation. Who's the therapist and who's the one needs therapy, you see? So you have this uppity attitude of people who are very, very deluded and very, very indoctrinated into the Antichrist falsity, who are now being taught to be very uppity, very uppity, very uppity, very uppity. To boss everybody else around. Say, no, we're equal to you. We're equal to you. We're entertaining extremely severe delusions and falsities, but we're equal to you. Those thoughts are just as good as yours. Those lead to happiness just the same as yours do. No, they don't. No, they don't. Going in the direction where happiness can't be found is not leading to the same happiness as going in the right direction at all. This is just total insanity to believe that. And the pharmaceuticals companies, it doesn't matter what direction you go in happiness. We have the happiness right here in a pill for you. So how dare we make these differentiations about which direction you're going? That's racist. It's sexist. It's bigoted. It's phobic. This is PC culture, pharmaceutical culture. Yeah, I was the Donald before there was the Donald. When I was young, I was like the Donald, you know. And telling people the truth, you know, oh, this is the truth, this is the truth. And I was so confident, you know, people said, who the heck do you think you are, you know? We don't like authenticity here. You know, you're in the wrong place. If you want to be authentic, you're not in the right place. And I said, well, I mean, you guys need help, you know. He goes, no, we don't. We're going to balance things out, you know. So anyway, we're bringing it to light. We're exposing it. This is the apocalypse. We're exposing the Antichrist. That's the apocalypse. So be part of the apocalypse. You know, this is awesome. Better in the 60s, as I said. Being part of the apocalypse is being aware, seeing, oh, this is what the Antichrist is up to. Oh, I get it. Jesus is back. And maybe in your mind you start to say, hey, wait a minute. Maybe there's somebody speaking this authentically, and he says, I am a student of Jesus. Absolutely, I am. And he says, Jesus is back. Maybe Jesus is back. And just start, you know, start just like, maybe, you know. Hey, maybe I can recover my authenticity. Maybe all is not lost. Maybe I don't have to go along with this PC Antichrist religion. Okay? And again, they say, oh, you know, the directions you go, you know, it doesn't matter. This one's saying that first, that happiness can be found by killing authenticity, and then that will lead to the vanishment of guilt, and then we'll be resurrected in true authenticity, even greater authenticity than before. We'll be greater than God now. That's the Antichrist direction, and Christ is saying we never did anything to God. There's nothing to atone for, and we just need to realize there's nothing we need to choose. There is no choice at all. We are completely authentic as we always have been. There's no guilt. We didn't do anything to God. All we need to do is forgive ourselves for the madness that we've had, and we will experience our perfection again. This is the teachings of Christ. Completely mutually exclusive directions. Okay? One says we don't need to do anything at all. Christ says we don't need to do anything at all. You don't need to kill your authenticity. You don't need to do anything at all. And just let it arise. You don't need to suppress it and kill it in order to get rid of guilt. There is no guilt. Completely mutually exclusive directions. One leads to happiness. The other leads to extreme misery. Darkness, spiritual darkness and misery. And there's no happiness found there. It doesn't work. One works. The other doesn't work. The pharmaceutical culture says they're the same. It says they're the same because our drugs are available to both equally. You want to get a painkiller? We manufacture painkillers equally. Both of you can buy a painkiller for what's bothering you. Whatever's bothering you, we got a painkiller for that. So there's no difference to us. Your money's green, both green to us. So it's stupid to be talking about these kind of differences. Those are stupid differences. We have the happiness in the pill here. See, this is the Antichrist. This is PC culture. This is disastrous. For your mind, for your clarity. Now, how do you protect yourself? People are saying, well, it's dangerous to say this. Well, you just say, hey, anyone has a problem with me, go straight to God and insist that God put full justice on me right this instant. That's it. That's it. I'm not making any deals with anybody. The only way you can be harmed is if you make a deal with somebody. Somebody will come to you and say, hey, I'm gonna rat you out to God. God hates you for saying this. And they convince you that the justice of God is going to be so severe upon you that it terrifies you. And then they say, hey, listen, God's being a little too harsh. They'll say, I think God might be a little too harsh. I'm not really that angry with you. But if you accept some lesser punishment from me, then, I won't rat you out to God. And then you end up agreeing to that. And then once you make that agreement, then you can be harmed. Then the body can be harmed. Absolutely. If you make an agreement to agree to that. So the protection, they say, absolutely not. Anyone has a problem with me, you go straight to God and rat me out this instant. In fact, I insist upon it. Totally rat me out. Tell God every terrible thing you can possibly think of about me and do it this instant and be absolutely adamant about it and demand of God that God give, true justice to me instantly. Full, true, final justice to me instantly. I absolutely insist upon it. That's it. You're finished. There's no more to talk about here. That's it. So this is what I want to pass on to those who are feeling crushed, their authenticity, think, oh my God, if I speak up, people will come after me and, attack me and so on. Well, just use this. Use this approach, saying, you go to God, of course. And of course, the way the pharmaceutical culture is trying to trick us and deceive us is through the use of the goddess archetype and saying that the goddess archetype has influence over God and that she'll rat you out to God. And they'll rat you out to the goddess, and then she in turn will go rat you out to God and convince God that to make an exception that you really are a bad person. She thinks you're a bad person, therefore God should. And this really paralyzes people here. This is why I always speak out the goddess being so dangerous to believe in the goddess, that she has some influence over God. Zero influence. Okay, zero influence. I tell the goddess, go right this instant, goddess, and absolutely use every possible persuasion you can on God. Do this instant. Use all your charms, all your persuasion. Go for it. And I'll accept whatever justice God gives to me this very instant. Full justice. Go for it. Come on. That's it. I'm finished with you. No more talk. No more bluff. Go do it. Go do it. Make my day and do it. Okay? So this is how you have to deal with the goddess, because this is what is paralyzing us here in fear. Our authenticity is being paralyzed. Because we think with this idea that somehow the goddess has influence on God. There is no goddess. That we just made it up. made it up. There's no two wills. God doesn't need to negotiate or make a deal. God knows we're perfect. And that's the will of God, and that's it. There's no one has any influence over God's will whatsoever. We completely have just made this up as a fantasy. So call the bluff of the goddess. Call the goddess's bluff. You have to do that. Otherwise, you're going to be very intimidated and go down into this PC hole, you know, tunnel, a black, dark tunnel. So you can stand up. Now, I don't know how possible it is to stand up in this world. You know, we're told that it'll get so severe in the end times that even the most authentic people, the saints of God, even they will have trouble, which is true. Which is absolutely true. How many saints do you see really standing up right now? Very, very few. And even them, you don't feel, you feel they're being a little nervous about authenticity, you know? Like, I better, you know, get in bed with the goddess, you know, just in case, you know? Very few are denouncing the goddess, you know, if any. Some Christians still do. But that's, you know, so this is the end times. Jesus is back already. This is what you have to hear. No, it's not some, see, as long as we put our happiness in the future, we'll always believe that Jesus is coming sometime in the future because we're not quite ready. You know, we haven't crushed our authenticity enough yet. But see, it's not true. Jesus is already back. Okay, so this is the problem we have, is we're so caught up in the belief that our happiness is in the future that we just cannot connect the dots and say, wait a minute, if Jesus is back now, we can never get to accept that he's already back. He's back now. This is the trouble we have. And I was able to get past this and I realized he is back. He announced to the world, I'm back. And like I said, but people heard him, but they didn't respond. He's like, no, well, it's too early. I don't feel quite ready. So nobody feels quite ready. Why? Because we bought into this lie of the Antichrist that first we have to destroy our authenticity to convince guilt that we died, a spirit died, and then we get our happiness. And they say, well, if Jesus is back now, that means my happiness is now. He's saying that happiness should be, but I'm not ready yet. So he couldn't have come back. And so we use this reverse logic of the Antichrist to conclude that he cannot be back. Without actually asking, are you back yet, Jesus? He'll say, yeah, I'm back. Just ask him. But nobody asks him. They use the logic, reverse logic of the Antichrist, saying, well, I'm not ready to be happy because I still feel some authenticity. Therefore, you can't be back yet. It's not possible. I'm not ready for you yet. But of course, Jesus' mission is to help expose the Antichrist and free us from the Antichrist and show us this faulty logic that we're using. Okay, how are we doing here? Pretty good. I'm on a roll. You're not even paying much attention to the time because we have to go big today. Now this video I have, I don't know what to do with it. Good Lord, I don't want to overtax people. You know, it's a problem of overloading. People are so crushed in their authenticity that it's like it's almost, you know, they're afraid of being overloaded now. The pharmaceutical industry and the consortium, pharmaceutical culture really is what it is experts at co-opting people, co-opting them. So you get some authenticity arises, then they co-opt it, you know, like that. And, you know, the Beatles were the perfect example. Superlative musicians and seemingly very authentic, you know, and they co-opted the Beatles and actually ended up using them to promote drugs more than anybody else. You know, they were the bellwether of all this. And of course John Lennon was very much aware of that and went along with it. You know, imagine there's no heaven, you know, all this kind of stuff. He was very much into believing in the happiness, Antichrist happiness, very much so. So I can say that he's no longer here, but even their authenticity, there's authenticity in musicians that gets co-opted, you know, it's not strong enough. It's very tough to not be co-opted, let's put it that way, for anybody. You know, I do it by just being, you know, invisible, pretty much invisible. I can't talk like this to people I meet. I never talk like this. For me, I just act like my authenticity is crushed. I basically, when I go out around people, anywhere I go, I pretend like my authenticity is absolutely crushed. You know, maybe that's why I have some infirmities. I said, my gosh, I got to pretend like I'm ill and sick and have troubles. Otherwise, they might start suspecting that I'm authentic. You know, can't. That's too dangerous here. Way too dangerous. People went to India, you know, from here because to try to find authenticity. They realized that the modern industrial complex, you know, in pharmaceutical industries, where it was crushing their authenticity, or at least convincing them that they had to find happiness. And so they fled to India and Nepal, and you know, hung out in Kathmandu and Varanasi and looked for gurus. They were looking for authenticity. And they found some. So they found some. They said, wow. Of course, they found a lot of fakers, too. Right? Who had their own agendas. Sure, Ayurveda, okay, there's these medicines. These are the medicines that work for you. They have their own connections with the medical industry over there, right? I mean, don't think that there hasn't been a long pharmaceutical history in India. My gosh, it goes back to Vedic times, you know? I mean, the whole Vedic religion was based on soma, basically, right? I mean, talk about pharmaceuticals. They said, this is how you're happy. You take soma, whatever soma ultimately turns out to be. But absolutely, it was based on it. So they came up with all sorts of compounds and minerals and various things, heavily, heavily into pharmaceuticals. The whole Vedic culture and Hindu culture has been using medicines forever, you know. And it's just they think that their medicines are better than Western medicine. But they're the same thing. It's all placebos. See, there's no difference, really. So and even in Hindu culture, you have a lot of teachers who are basically pushers for, you know, their version of the pharmaceutical industry. Absolutely. And you have a lot of those people, the new age health people, you know, doctor this, doctor that, you know, says, oh yes, this, you know, we have a long history of Ayurvedic wisdom, and this is how you do this. You take a little bit of lemon, you know, this grass here, and this mineral here, and then balance this out with this, and this herb here, and I'm an herbal, a Chinese herbalist, dude. It's all the same. It's all placebos. It's the same thing. They're all playing for the same team, actually. But in India, but then there's some authentic ones who say, no, it's all in the mind. It's all in the mind. Like Rama Maharshi, lady, your son was bit by a snake. All the time people bring and say, heal my son, my daughter. You know, she's sick, he's sick. You know, so I'm sick, my parents are sick. You know, he just didn't do anything. He just sat there quietly. And then later on, it turns out they'd meet whatever placebo they needed to get well. But he knew it's all in the mind. It's all just dream. Didn't respond at all. There's authenticity. That's authenticity. You know, and we look at that and say, I don't know if we're ready for that much authenticity. You know, we're so crushed in America that we don't even hardly know what authenticity is anymore. We think it's some musical star, you know, who's bought and paid for a million times over by the pharmaceutical antichrist culture. Lemmings, you know, lemmings going down into that dark tunnel. So we have tools. Jesus is helping introduce these tools. I'm trying to help out. My prayer is every day that God, you know, let the mission of Jesus be tremendously successful, and let those who can't help Jesus, let them help Jesus be successful. What other prayer could there be? You know, really, however you want to say it, let the mission of truth be successful. Let the mission of true salvation be successful here, and let us be very helpfully successful in helping out. That's all. I just help, use me, God, to help Jesus. That's it. So I'm, you know, fabulously helpful. What other prayer, you know, could there be here, really? And I found that the intimidation is very clever, the Antichrist. It's saying, we're going to rat you out to God. And then when you say, I'll go ahead, then they say, oh, well, we're going to go to our mom, and our mom is going to rat out to God. Now, keep in mind that when we grow up or socialized in our lives, that The mom usually has the dad do the punishing. Okay. This is what I found out. It's amazing. Whenever something that has to be done that makes someone really angry, like, I'm always asked to do it. The man is asked to do it so the woman doesn't look so bad. She's the one insisting you do it. This has to be done. I say, why don't you do it? No, you got to do it. You know, like the animal, them being really angry at you. You're like, oh, you forced this medicine. You did something. Oh, I hate you so much. I said, well, I didn't want to do it. She so told me that I had to do it. And of course, she said, oh, no, poor cow, what's wrong with you? You know, oh, you're upset. Let me comfort you. You know, so she looks good and the man looks bad. So we're so used to dad, you know, having the mother going to dad and saying, hey, you need to punish the child because the child's getting out of line. So the man, you know, is authoritarian to the child. And the child's like, oh, my dad is so terrible. He's so awful. And the mother comes, why are you crying? Oh, he's so harsh, poor baby. You know, I'm so sorry. You had to, you know, she seems like the good one. Women are very sly about this. And they always seem like they're the good ones. They don't like to be the ones that you know, crack down too hard. Well, so we're used to, you know, we're thinking like, hey, you know, it's the mother that goes to the father, which then causes a severe punishment on us. So we're very scared, you know, if somebody says, hey, I'm going to go tell mom, you know, mom, that you did this, and I'm going to insist that she go tell dad, you know, that kind of thing, because she's got influence on dad. Now we're also aware that the mother's very clever, you know. She's like, she says, hey, you need to punish the child. He's been acting up. I want you to really scare him bad. And the man says, okay. And then she says, but when then I'll come in when you after you scare him real bad, or I'll say that you're gonna punish him severely, and then I'm gonna say, but don't worry, I'll go talk to him. I'll go talk to your father. Your father's very angry at you. So then, like, the kid acts out. He's doing something. The mom's really upset. So I gotta control this kid better. So she'll say, and then she'll say to the kid, you know, I told your dad about what you did, and he's furious with you, and he's going to punish you very severely. And the child says, no, mom, please, please, I'll act better. She says, well, you promised? You promised? Oh, yeah, mom. She says, okay, I'll go talk to your father, and I'll try to convince him to go easy on you, but I don't know. He's really angry with you. He goes, oh, mom, please help me, mom. I'm so scared, you know, dad. And then she goes, and then they go, the mom goes, hey, it worked. It worked. You know, he decided to shape up. You know, and they say, oh, great. So there's a good cop, bad cop thing that they use on children. So we're socialized this way. The mom is very good at playing the role of the good cop and gets the man to play the role of the bad cop, even if the man doesn't want to do that. You know, so we have this belief that God wants to punish us, is really angry at us, and the mother protects us from too severe punishment. So when we think, so we're easily induced into making a deal, thinking like, oh my gosh, I might have angered God, you know. And then the goddess will say, hey, you know what? I'm gonna talk to God. If you agree to shape up and stop being authentic, I'm gonna go to God and I'm gonna tell him, hey God, you know, he promised me that he'd shape up, and so, you know, it's not such a big deal. Why don't you go easy on him? And then God will go easy on you, like that. We're so vulnerable to this psychological trick, the psychological ploy, because our socialization, okay? So when this bluff is used on us, we're very, very vulnerable to it. It's a lie, of course. It's an absolute lie. God is not angry at us in the slightest bit. It's the goddess that's telling us, oh my God, she says, I'm close to God. I know how God feels. I got inside information. I'm a goddess. That's what I am. I know how God is feeling. And she says, I got to tell you, God's really, really upset with you. You've been acting way too authentic here and ruining the path of happiness for us. And he's furious because he wants happiness for us. And he knows that, you know, how to get a happiness, of course, going in the wrong direction. The goddess is telling us to go in the wrong direction. He knows that, and you're interfering with that. And he's decided he's really going to crack down on you very severely. And I'm really sorry. But she goes, but you know what? And she's waiting for us to get all frightened. Oh, I don't know. Really, really? Well, I'll tell you. She says, I'll tell you what. You know, what you need to do is you need to stop being so authentic, okay? And you got to promise me, and we got to do make some. You got to be re-educated, so you're not so authentic. And if you do that, I'm going to go talk to God, and I'm going to calm him down. I know how to calm God down. I'm a goddess. That's what I do. I'm aware of God's anger, and then I calm God's anger down. That's my shtick, you know. So I'll do that for you. If we take steps to crush your authenticity, apologize to everybody for being authentic. I'm so sorry, everybody, that I was authentic for a moment. I let something slip out of my mouth that was authentic. I'm a horrible person. I can't believe how terrible I am. That's not really me. I'm not really truly authentic. I'm really truly inauthentic, you know. And I want everybody to know that I'm really truly am inauthentic. It's just that this was some weird vestigial outlier, you know, that just sort of bubbled up. I don't know where it came from. Yeah, I'm so sorry it came out. It's crazy. I'm really committed to going on the path of my true inauthenticity and going along with you wonderful inauthentic folks so that we can all eventually find our happiness and neutralize guilt and then we'll all be happy. So yeah, I just hope I can get back in your good graces. I know I can't. I don't know I don't deserve it. I know I never will, but I'm just going to try anyway, and I'm just so sorry. I'm sorry anybody I hurt by my authenticity. You know, it's just awful. And you know, and then the goddess says, well, you know, I think I'm going to put a good word in for you with God. And they'll calm him down. He'll calm him down and, you know, he'll let you be re-educated. You know, he won't crush you. He won't annihilate you. He'll let you re-educate. I think I can talk him into that. And he said, thank you, God. Oh, my God, you're so wonderful. I'm never going to stop thanking you. You know, I mean, I can't believe how grateful I am to you. You know, you saved my life. You saved me from being destroyed, annihilated. I mean, I didn't even know there was you even could do such a thing. It's just amazing. I don't even know where you came from. I mean, this is like the grace. It must be such grace. I don't deserve grace that you're able to intervene like with God, to God like that for me. I mean, I can't believe it. I don't even know where this came from. It's like a miracle. It's just astonishing. I mean, I'm so grateful. Thank you so much. Wow. You know, you're just so relieved. You say, oh my gosh, I have an advocate who can calm God down if I start being authentic. You know, I mean, this is horrible. I got this, I don't know where this authenticity keeps bubbling up from somewhere. I haven't been able to kill it yet. I don't understand what's going on, but at least I have this advocate, this guy who understands my problems and can intercede with God for me and keep me from being annihilated. This is just like, oh my God, I feel so much better about myself now. I feel so much better. Oh God, wow. I live for another day. So, this is what's going on inside of us, right? I'm just outing. This is the apocalypse. I'm outing what's gone on inside of us. Look, there is no goddess. It's all a lie. This is the ego. This is the antichrist. This is deception. God is not angry with us. Never, never, in any way, there's no punishment because we never did anything to God. We cannot. God is completely invulnerable. The will of God cannot be touched. It's invulnerable. We cannot change the will of God. We did nothing to God. God can never be angry at us. It's impossible. And certainly, God loves our authenticity, right? That's what God created us as completely authentic. So the idea of being that somehow God's angry at us for expressing authenticity is completely absurd. Okay, so this whole goddess shtick is lies on every account, every angle, complete self-deception lie. God is not angry and can never be angry at us. There is no punishment from God whatsoever towards us. Nothing but love, acceptance, absolute love from God. That's it. Love's our authenticity, our freedom. Okay? All right. So there's no need for anyone to intercede. And plus, there couldn't be an intercession. God's will is inviolate. Cannot be changed in the slightest bit. The idea that somehow that someone can change God's will, God's justice, is a completely impossible, absurdly arrogant. So there's no anger from God. Changing, intervening with God is completely impossible. So on all those, and God loves our authenticity. So on all those accounts, the goddess is a complete fabrication, a mental fabrication that we've made to frighten ourselves, to say, hey, the path to happiness by crushing authenticity, you know, you can do that path. We'll find a way to make it happen. You know, because you have to believe that God hates us and wants to kill us and is so upset with us and, you know, all this kind of stuff. And so, we've got to get rid of this authenticity that it's evil and wrong and all this stuff. So we invent the goddess. The goddess is our own invention. It doesn't exist. It's a bluff. It's a mental bluff that we use to terrorize ourselves. To lead us away from our authenticity. That's all the goddess does. It leads us away from our authenticity in God as we pursue another will, an imaginary will that doesn't exist, thinking that that's where we find our happiness. How are we doing on this one? This is more normal as far as the gigabytes use. The other one, I have no idea, went 3 hours and 40 minutes. This is going to be more 2.5 hours. Exact same lighting, exact same everything. That's why I say I cannot explain why one goes an hour longer than the other. It's inexplicable. So, a little breath of authenticity here. Authenticity, 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 authenticity. This video that I've made is this artistic ingratitude, in appreciation and gratitude for the return of Jesus. You know, this gives us like an experience of sublime. It's somewhat sublime and majestic and sublime. There's a feeling to it that this is just wow. There's a wow feeling to it. So this helps our authenticity. It helps our authenticity. It helps us breathe. Starting breathe the air of authenticity is what we need to start doing. We need to start breathing the air of authenticity. And so many of us we're all terrified. Oh no! The goddess will go to God and tell us, hey, you know, he's acting up again. He's trying to be authentic again. You know, God, that you'll never find happiness if you do that. And your will, God, is for our happiness, right? Well, of course you have to be angry then with somebody who's interfering with that, right? And this is what we're afraid the goddess is going to go. Well, no, God's will for us is that we are happy. Not that we're going to be happy. We are. And we can never not be happy. So God knows that there's nothing, no way we can interfere with our happiness. So it's ridiculous to say that I'm interfering with our happiness. No one's interfering. We are delusionally going in the wrong direction. Many are, the Antichrist. But that does not interfere with our true happiness. It's still there for us. We just have to realize that we don't have a choice between happiness and unhappiness. It doesn't exist. Or happiness in this way or happiness in the other way. No, there's only one happiness. Period. So, you know, as we get scared, oh, the goddess is going to tell on me. People are going to tell. No, God won't listen to the goddess at all. Absolutely doesn't hear her at all. Pays no attention whatsoever. And then we say, well, that's sexist. You know, God's sexist. He's not listening to the goddess. And we play that card, you know, the whole sexism card. Like, well, if you say the goddess doesn't influence God, you're being sexist. You know, that's the whole idea of sexism, is really to reinforce this delusion of the goddess having power over God, which is just the idea of this other will having power over God's will. There is no will but God's will. There is no will but God's will. There is no goddess will at all. Okay, so, but this is this whole, you know, you're being sexist, is really attacking God's will, thinking we're attacking God's will, where we have to allow for the goddesses, that there's it's like as if reality is some sort of joint partnership between God's will and the goddess's will, and they negotiate, okay, what's happiness going to be? Well, maybe it's like this, and well, maybe it's like this. Okay, in this instance, it's some kind of, you know, marriage between the two wills or something. This is utterly absurd, totally delusional, totally arrogant. No such situation whatsoever, not even a trace of it. And of course, we're told we're sexist. You don't believe in the power of the goddess. I don't believe in the power of the tooth fairy either, actually. See? Or the Easter bunny, you know? There's just as much truth to the Easter Bunny as there is to the goddess. Absolutely. Both zero truth to any of it. Okay? So I say, call the bluff. Go ahead. Talk to God. Go ahead. Well, God doesn't listen to me because, you know, God's sexist. Well, you know, you don't exist, so how can God listen to what doesn't exist? There is no other will. God only listens to God's will because that's the only will there is. Right? So, but they've made great inroads with this whole sexism thing to paralyze people's authenticity. Say, wait a minute, that doesn't sound fair. I mean, she should have some influence, you know. See, it's not like husband and wife. God is just singular. You know, there's just one God. That's it. There's one God, one will. There is no other. There isn't some partnership in reality with some other will at all. And the Antichrist insists that there is. So of course, that's sexist. You need to have a balance in the relationship. You got to listen to the woman. You got to listen to the goddess. If she's angry with you, then she has a right for God to punish you. You know, if she says, "I want this guy punished," and God to say, "Well, okay, I'll do that for you. I need to listen to you and respect what you want done," that kind of thing. So we keep using this false anthropomorphic model for reality in God, and which is, again, the Antichrist. Using an anthropomorphic model for God is Antichrist. It's very delusional. There's just one will. That's it. We abide in the one will, in the safety of the one will, in the peace of the one will, in the one will of God. There's no conflict at all. Complete safety, absolute bliss. And meanwhile, the Antichrists are screaming, "Sexist! You're sexist! God's a sexist!" You know. Well, see, there's just one will, and you're being arrogant. And actually, what you're saying is, in saying that we're being sexist, actually you're being arrogant. You just go back to him and say, you're being arrogant in trying to believe that you could create a separate will from God. That's just sheer arrogance. So go ahead and make your claims to God. And then they try to tell someone, you need to put the pressure on God. If you're good, you need to pressure God and say, God, I'm going to rebel against you because you're sexist, you know, and you're not listening to the goddess. So that's another angle that they use on us, very severe angle the Antichrist uses on us. I'll have to, you know, allow what kind of response to that. You know, I hadn't seen that quite clearly enough until now. It's like, wow, that's a very vicious ploy, isn't it? They're telling us that, well, God's obviously sexist and we need to change God and we need to put pressure on changing God. I say, well, look, God can't be changed. So, you know, if you don't like it, you know, then you're not going to like it, but he can't change it. And they say, well, then you certainly don't condone what's wrong. I said, well, yeah, then they say, so they keep pressuring you on that. Okay, so we're being aware of what the pressure points are here, the psychic pressure points that we're being subjected to. Our psyche is being, you know, being these pressure points are being, you know, they've got the claws in there, pushing our pressure points, like, paralyzing us. We can't function. We can't be authentic. I say, no, God loves us all perfectly. So how can that be unfair to anyone? Where's the unfairness? We have perfect freedom, perfect bliss, perfect happiness. Everyone has everything. How could that be sexist or unfair? How could it be unfair? To what? What's it being unfair to? A delusion? Arrogance? No, it's up to God. It's up to us to drop our arrogance. Because we're trying to diminish ourselves, and God refuses to allow us to be diminished. How's that being unfair? You can apply any term you want to, sexist. You really mean we're being, God's unfair? I say, God's perfectly fair. You're the one who's trying to be unfair to God by dispossessing God of God's creation. And then claiming that God's being unfair, you're not allowing this dispossession to take place, therefore, God, you're unfair. This is just nothing but whimsical arrogance, okay? And that'll get you nothing. You have no gravitas in that whatsoever. So we got to release these pressure points that have been, you know, paralyzing our authenticity. And they're so convinced that's gonna work. They're like so confident that they're going to win, and they're going to paralyze authenticity, totally paralyze it. They're just like, huh? Completely dismissive, like, you're an idiot if you think otherwise. Complete idiot. We're going to win for sure. Well, you haven't won against Jesus. You didn't stop Jesus from coming back. They just ignore that. Well, Jesus didn't come back. They want you to ignore it too, but you don't ignore it. Say, hey, wait a minute. There's one key factor right there that where they lost, big time. Where the pure authenticity has come back to this world. They didn't stop that. They didn't stop pure authenticity. So they're bluffing. They're bluffing. They're just expert bluffers. Call their bluff. So we work on that here. We work on these videos. We help you, encourage you to call the bluff psychically. Call the bluff. Be empowered. Be authentic. Be empowered to be authentic. True authenticity will say, I don't need this world at all. I don't need to be here. Why should I hang out in the hell of inauthenticity, where authenticity is attacked at every opportunity? Why should I hang out here? I don't even need to hang out here. I can go somewhere else. That's authentic. They say, no, you can't do that. The goddess didn't give you permission, blah, 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 blah. I said, well, goddess doesn't exist. So you're worried about the feelings of what doesn't exist? How arrogant is that? As make-believe, tooth fairy arrogance. You're the one that needs to repent from just sheer arrogance. Sheer arrogance will never make you happy. You're trying to deny your happiness to yourself and blame it on God. You know, this is nonsense. Repent. Now, Jesus is a lot better than I am at this. I want more Jesus. Come on, Jesus, you know. Bring the authenticity here, please. Please. And so we can learn more authenticity from you, you know. Get the flavor, get the taste of it. But really, it's the goddess that's being sexist, that's stereotyping God and claiming that she should be able to seduce him, isn't it? It's the goddess that's being sexist. She's saying, my charms and seduction is even God can't resist it. That's the one being sexist, that men are like just, you know, pigs. They can't resist the erotic charms of women. And they're incapable of it. And so they're projecting that onto God. That's what's sexist. It's the goddess who's sexist. There you go. Yeah, no, I'm not going to support sexism. That's the most terrible example of sexism possible. That you think even God can, you can even seduce God into violating God's will. You know, that's absolute arrogant sexism to the highest degree possible. I'm not going to serve that. You lose. You lose, goddess. You lose. You lost me. You're finished. You're finished. That's it. I'm done with you. There you go. So many people are trapped in this. So many people are trapped. So many men are trapped. Women are trapped. Both. You know, they're so severely trapped in it. But I'm showing you now how to turn it around. You can turn it around. It's the goddess that's absolutely sexist. I mean, she's the worst sexist pig ever. Okay, it can never be anything worse than that. She insists that God fall, but fall, God's will is subject to her charms. Can you imagine that, how sexist that is? She's saying, I'm superior to God. I'm inherently superior because I'm a woman, and the men are the male. Suppose, you know, first of all, you're anthropomorphizing God, which is godophobic or something, you know, whatever, bigoted. We'll call it bigoted, and then saying that God has no choice but to succumb to your charms because you're superior. You know, you have sovereignty over that. You can force God's will to change. That's being sexist, stereotyping God. As all God's interested in is the charms of the flesh, you know. Stereotype. Total stereotype. Women are stereotyping men to a totally sexist way in this world now. They're extreme sexist, actually, under the leadership of the goddess. They're insanely sexist. The worst sexism we've ever seen on this planet. The worst stereotyping that's ever taken place is taking place right now. And it's the men that are being stereotyped. So we can reject that. Hey, I reject sexism. I'm for all for authenticity. I reject sexism. So goodbye, goddess. You're done. You've been outed. The apocalypse has just happened to you. Wow. Right? Hey, the apocalypse has just happened to you too, you know. Welcome to the apocalypse, everyone, my friends. Welcome to the apocalypse, my friends. Where we start to breathe the air of authenticity. Start believing Jesus is back. How could I be talking like this if I didn't believe that Jesus is back? I absolutely believe Jesus is back. I experienced it. So I am pushing authenticity. I am breathing the air of authenticity. I'm giving you the oxygen of authenticity right now. It's better than Trump. It's way better than Trump. Because this deals with severe diabolical plots that has been paralyzing our authenticity at the deepest level and flipping the script on all that. You see, this is what we really want. Trump is just talking about, well, if I'm president, you know, maybe we'll make the country, we'll build better, we'll build a wall and get some, you know, get better bridges and, you know, we'll negotiate tougher with the Chinese, you know. Okay, that's small potato stuff. You know, this here is the whole ball of wax. We're flipping the script on the goddess, absolutely flipping the script on the goddess, which is the most paralyzing strategy we've come up with, really. We're flipping the script on all the strategies that we've come up with. Whatever strategies we've come up with, we're flipping the script.